Hello! Welcome back to Dress to Quest. I'm Nathan. I am the DM here, and we are an actual play live stream playing D&D in the Ghosts of Saltmarsh campaign setting. And we're all level 9 right now, getting ready for something big. Now that that's out of the way, let's do some quick player intros. We'll do a recap. And actually, let's do player intros first. I wanted to do some shout outs really quick, but let's do player intros. So, starting with Chris.
Hi, everybody. I'm Chris, and I play Aiza Marley, a Demetian human wizard, with my trusty book, Archive.
Oh, yes.
Looking forward to some fun and games.
Excellent. Next up, we have Eric.
Hey guys, I'm playing Glum. He's a battlesmith artificer gnome with his trusty hand crossbow pew pew.
yes, definitely. Next we have Erica.
All right, hi, I'm Erica. I play Rin Swiftbow, Beastmaster Ranger, Wood Elf, and every game she summons her falcon named Bert. Her bow doesn't have a name, but you know, pew pew's good.
Pew pew the second, or the first, because Rin was first. awesome. And then last but not least, we have Space.
Hey guys, I'm Space. I play Aspen, the ASMR, Divine Soul Sorcerer, Hexblade Warlock. And yeah, let's get into it.
Yeah, awesome. All right, well, before we get into the recap, I just want to do a couple of quick shout-outs. So tonight I'm going to be using a map, and I just want to quickly plug the Reddit user where I found this map. So thank you to, I think it's Uchideshi34, I don't know usernames, but here's a link to, for those, please players don't click on the link, but here it is for if anybody wants to check that out. I also would love to quickly throw a shout out to my good friend Claire. Claire has helped me a lot in developing this campaign in general. We're kind of writing partners together, and they also have helped me with some stuff coming up soon here with the encounters. So I just wanted to shout out Claire, and you can see Claire over on our show that we stream Wednesday nights, Story Reckless. And here's the link to that. Please swing by and check it out if you have the time. Cool, thanks. That is it for shout outs for the beginning of the show. Unless Eric, you wanna plug your TikTok channel real quick?
Since you brought it up, sure. at TikTok.com at Dad Jokes and Dragons. We have daily pun skits with Lorwick the Gray and Rin Swippo, and they're goofy and they're quick, and people seem to like them.
Oh yeah, they're awesome. You guys are really killing it over there. Okay, awesome. Well, with that, let's do a quick recap and jump right into it. So, last we left off, our heroes had just defeated Mr. Dory, one of the corrupt council members of Thornhold, and discovered he was involved with a cult of Thera's Dune being run by a figure named the Whisperer, which you all discovered to be an Aboleth by the name of Skolthka. Gathering up your supplies, taking a rest, and determining where the lair of Skolthka and the cult may be based, you poked around town and found yourselves in the Low Quarter District at the base of Frother's Lamp, the old lighthouse in the center of this district. This decrepit old stone lighthouse with shanties built all around it, standing there in the streets, you noticed that some of the denizens were keeping an eye on you, so you quickly darted off into the shadows and went into stealth mode as you went to approach the entrance to the lair. Going over the clues and talking with the various folks that you knew within town, you determine that the entrance is likely where the shadow of the lighthouse intersects with the doorway at sunset, This doorway is at the back of an old galley that has been pulled up onto shore and kind of used as a foundation for this decrepit old structure of buildings. It appeared that the galley went up to the base of a sunken apartment complex made of stone, and there was a set of double doors that were leading in deeper. Above that was a tangled mess of shanties, and Glum noticed that all of these buildings around this entrance were abandoned. So, with the aid of Rin and Pass Without Trace, you snuck into this shanty complex, got above the entryway, and pried open a hole leading down below into the hallway where the double doors led deeper within. Unfortunately, though, Aize's water elemental companion was unable to stay quite as quiet and stealthy, and drew the attention of the strange aquatic squid monster creatures that you've encountered before, and a battle ensued at the entrance to this lair. You managed to dispatch them all. There was a couple of crazy moments. There's a fire that got ignited. There was a big blast of ice from Aize's fireball spell that he can convert to ice. But defeating all of the creatures, you now stood here above the hole that Glum had made into the hallway, and Aspen could just barely make out the sound of what sounded like chanting from deeper within the chambers. So, with that, let's jump over to the map and kick this off. All of you have just defeated these creatures. They're lying dead on the floor and on the deck below you, Glum. Glum, you have kind of scampered down below to chase that one down, and looking up top, you can see the entryway into the shanties where you all were hiding out, and there is indeed a fire still burning and crackling from the grease spell that Aspen had cast. But with all of you here and waiting, what's your next move here? What are you hoping to do next?
I would like to.
I guess.
Go ahead, sir.
There's a hole in the floor. That's where we were headed in the first place. I reckon we just jumped down.
Okay.
I should send Cherry down first, I think.
Okay. So you want to have Cherry slip down through the hole into the hallway below?
First thing first. I'll go look for Glum. Because he's not with us.
Yeah, you poke your head out the door and you can see Glum down below riding atop Scott, the mechanical dog. Glum, you see Aize pointing.
Okay, I hop down and I pull out that oversized wrench semi-magically out of my pouch. Mm-hmm. And I do that same kind of video game animation where I just kind of crank on the back of Scott, and I use my mending spell two or three times and then get his hit points back.
Okay, cool. I think mending takes about a minute to cast or something, so.
Oh, does it? Okay, great.
Which is fine. I mean, just throwing it out there.
This is good for me to know. Let me check real quick.
Yeah, maybe double check that, but I'm.
One minute. Yeah. 1 minute.
Well, that's a good reminder. I look to Captain Aspen and I say, "Oh, mon capitaine, could you spare some healing for Cherry?
Is anybody else really hurt, or?" Let's look around. Nobody else is really hurt.
Aerolith looks fine. She shrugs. I'm good.
She didn't do anything. I will. Glum, do you need some?
Haven't been hit yet. But I will.
If you bring Scott over, I can get both him and Cherry. I think I can heal Scott, right?
That's a good question. But I have mending, and I get it for free, and I can heal him for free, so I got it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I will heal Cherry then. Is she really bad, Aize? Or you're muted.
Moderately injured. She's down 27 hit points.
We'll heal her. Let's see. I would do a cure wounds at second level.
She's down 10.
Cool. Okay.
No,
go for it.
I will dig around in my pouch for one of these two old potions of healing potions I have. I'm sorry, I didn't realize I had them for the longest time because they don't light up green.
Yeah, that's fine.
And I will give one to, I will say, here you go, Cherry. And I pour it into her.
Okay. It infuses throughout her water elemental body.
And heal her for 6, I guess. There it is.
Okay, cool.
See, we're making every effort to keep you alive. Please don't murder me. And just wait for Glum to join us before we proceed.
Okay, cool. Glum, how long are you going to spend doing mending on Scott?
So it's 2d8 or 1d8 per... why don't you keep moving with everybody real quick so I can look it up and not stop the stream?
Great.
Go ahead.
Okay, so everyone else, as Glum is out there working on Scott, what are the rest of you doing? Aize, you want to send Cherry down first?
I don't want to start any kind of engagement without Glum present.
Okay. Yeah. We'll say, because I think that the way that the spell works, it's probably only a minute long per casting, so it's only going to be 5 minutes at most. We'll say that that time passes without incident, and Glum will be able to join you all. And it should be without issue.
Okay, so it's 2d6 hit points. Each time I cast it, he's down 10. I'll just roll quick.
Okay, cool. Yeah, let's see how lucky you get. Maybe you'll roll a...
That okay. All right, first one.
There you go, 9 hit points.
Okay, and next one, he's only down 10, so 2 minutes it takes.
2 minutes. Okay, so 2 minutes of time with Glum there. And you see at one point Scott's leg sort of doing the twitchy, like, as Glum is fixing him up. And eventually, Glum, you are able to stride up and join up with the rest of the party. I'm assuming you want to go up with the rest of the party, Glum?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Let's put you up there.
I will spend the time to pop out my Pearl of Power and use it.
Okay, cool. Go for it.
Get back the third level spell that I already expended.
Okay. With all of you freshened up and ready to go, you can see the hole there before you, leaning down into the damp hallway. Who would like to go first?
Cherry! After you, my dear.
Okay, so Cherry will sort of squeeze and slip in through almost like a large teardrop and down onto the floor below. She, when she kind of rises up to her full height, she essentially fills this entire hallway. It is a 10-foot wide hallway you can see below. Anybody else going in, or you want her to do anything?
I tell Cherry, please catch me and lower me to the ground.
Okay. Yeah, Cherry will turn and raise up her liquid hands, and Aize, easy enough if you want to jump down into her.
I jump down into her.
Okay, it's very odd, like the water does give resistance and kind of pushes back, and there's like bubbles forming around where you're sitting. You do get wet, but she lowers you down into the hallway.
Please catch anyone else who jumps down.
She agrees in her strange language, and who's going next?
Aerolith.
All right. Yes, sure. and Aerolith will be lowered down into the hallway.
Be right behind you.
Okay.
So
Rin dropping down below. And I'm Glum or Aspen, would you like to go next?
I'll go.
Okay, and then Glum taking up the rear as you all drop down into this hallway. And Glum, you falling in behind. Here, I'll drop you in there, Glum. Boop. All right, all of you drop down into this damp, soggy hallway. The floorboards here, much like above, kind of give and bounce like a strange sponge. The hallway itself is really intense with the smell of mildew, and you just see before you this simple hallway leading to another set of double doors off to the west of on the map. What would you guys like to do?
I clicked on it and it opened up. I'm sorry. Maybe I shouldn't have done that.
You clicked on what?
I thought I was clicking the map, but I ended up clicking the... it's a lock. Oh, that's cool. It's a door. All right.
Oh, that is really cool. Oh, I didn't know it could do that.
Oh, all right.
Here, I will... I mean, it isn't locked, but I'm going to lock it for now so that y'all can't... I'm learning these new features. That's really cool. All right. So, yeah, what do you guys want to do? You do see the door there.
I want to make a perception check.
Go for it.
To listen in and see if I hear anything.
Yeah.
Okay. 11. Why is that roll of advantage? 11.
11. Okay. Aspen, as you all quietly drop down into this hallway and you start to listen very intently, you start to hear that chanting very clearly coming from the other side of those doors. I don't think any of you speak the language. You've heard it before, though. It is abyssal that is slowly being chanted on the other side of those doors. And yeah, that's kind of what you see here, other than just the hallway itself.
I'll let everyone know.
Mm-hmm.
I hear the chanting from the other side of this door. And the other door behind us, was that double door leading into this place?
Yes, that leads out into the opening area where you guys entered from. Or you kind of bypassed it, but yeah.
Okay.
I suspect we have to prepare for a fight.
Glum is going to cast... one of his new third level spells. He's going to cast Intellect Fortress on himself.
Ooh.
And that will look like he's going to pull out of his pouch basically a little ball with kind of inscriptions and writings that look like it's kind of gnomish in nature, but also moderately mechanical. And he puts it on his forehead and he pushes it in and briefly see like a glow in his head, and then it goes away.
Okay. Does it actually like disappear into your forehead?
Yeah. So once the spell is done, then you can't tell he has it. Yeah.
Okay. Disappears into your forehead with a flash of light. Cool. Anyone else?
Rin just says, "Well, I'm assuming we're not walking out the way we came," and casts aid for Aize and Aspen and Glum.
Glum still has the aid from before.
I still have one.
Did you do it before?
Yeah. What
was that?
I have 5 extra hit points. Day?
Yeah, you're helpful. Yeah, it was today.
I thought that I only did pass without a trace in beast sense.
No, we all still have our 5 hit points from that day.
I think you did it right before we started fighting the little squid things.
All right. Let's just say she says equip.
Aize moves to the back of the party.
Okay.
Well, maybe it's time for Cherry to see what's in there.
Yeah, I'll follow closely behind Cherry if I can.
Oh, you're muted, Aize. Yeah.
Cherry, could you please open those doors and protect yourself?
Okay.
Until I give you other orders.
So... She surges forward towards the doors, and she's just going to slam them open and spill out into the room. And a few things happen. So she comes spilling out into the room, kind of splashing water across the stone floor. Inside, all of you can see there is low lantern light illuminating kind of a stone cavernous chamber. Within this chamber, you can see these big, thick stone pillars rising up to support the ceiling. Everything in here as well is sort of damp and kind of dripping with water. There is mildew and fungus kind of clinging to all the walls and kind of wet slime. And the entire room is filled with old, kind of rotting benches like you would expect to see at any temple to any god you would be within a town. But these are all kind of cobbled together and pulled into this space. And the space, that chanting, as soon as the door busts open, that chanting washes through into the room and kind of fills the hallway that you're in, and then abruptly stops and is cut off mid-chant as it kind of like ripples out, and it's stopping as the crowd of 100 people within the room all notice the giant elemental come splashing into the room and kind of jerk to the side and turn and all look at the door. And you can just see this entire crowd of cultists all there standing before an altar at the back of the room. At the back of the room, you can see down this this large space far off to the west, there is this large, from this distance, and in this brief of a moment, you can't quite make it out, but there is a large fish-like shape that is suspended from the ceiling, probably a good 15 to 20 feet in length. And it's kind of sagging downwards, suspended by what look to be nets and rope. And that's kind of all you make out in this brief moment. And it is, it appears to be suspended above a pool of sort of filthy, murky water with stone steps leading down into this big pool. But everyone turns and looks as you all come busting into the room. And they all smile their crooked smiles at you, and you can see the little glints of their eyes in the dim lamplight as they all stare. And suddenly all of them in unison go, and let out a wail. I need everybody to roll initiative. Okay, we're gonna kick this off. So I am not going to put 100 tokens on the board.
What? what kind of Mickey Mouse outfit is this?
I was expecting my computer to crash for realism.
Remember, I roll twice because I have advantage.
Yes.
Good thing I rolled twice.
So, so real quick, I'm just curious, because I need to know, when you guys look at the initiative tracker right now, when you look at the turn order, what do you see on there? Do you just see yourselves?
I see Aize, I see Aspen, I see Ren.
Yeah. And that's it?
Yes,
okay, perfect. Because I have to add some hidden things and I don't want you guys to see it, and I don't know if it's working, so just making sure.
Oh, I also see Aboleth, your mother.
Excuse me.
I see a Kraken. What the hell?
I see Thanos.
Oh, man.
But we'll be okay, because I also see the Dread Pirate Roberts.
I anticipate a boring session tonight.
Indeed. Aize, what is your what is your dexterity score?
Seventeen.
Okay, good to know.
I wasn't going to say anything yet, but I'm pretty sure I recognize this room.
You do?
Yeah, I pulled it out of someone's mind.
Oh, yeah. That's right. Who was it? I think it was Aerolith, right?
Probably. Yeah. Probably Aerolith or some memory that she had, and this was the room we were looking for.
Correct. Yes, in fact, I mean, this is all happening so fast, but Aerolith is up at the front. I guess I'll put Aerolith up here with you, Aspen. Aspen probably catches it. She does kind of catch her breath and sort of take a couple steps back in that brief moment. All right, I need to also get Aerolith's... Oh, I didn't have Aerolith's stat block ready. Of course I didn't. Let me get that up. Sorry, a little slip up there. Talk amongst yourselves as I pull this up. There it is.
I say, oh, this is it. This is this forgotten temple of he who shall be nameless. There's probably something really interesting in that pit. Ooh.
Okay, awesome. It looks like I got everybody. I have Aize, Rin, Aerolith, Aspen. Oh, I'm not seeing Glum. Why didn't Glum show up? What did you get, Glum?
23.
Nice. Oh, you go first.
Okay.
Okay. Let me. Okay. Here we go. So, kicking it off, we have Glum. Glum, you see a crowd of 100 people before you, and they are all wailing and looking like they're about to start charging at your group.
Alrighty. I will move with.
And I'm going to just put this token on the board as a representation of the crowd, but it's not, again, I'm not putting 100 people on the map.
I'll move there, and I'm going to. So this right here is. What is this?
I mean, it's just, I just need a token to track the crowd, but there is a crowd of 100 people, and that token is kind of representing their pool of hit points, essentially, if you do attack them. What I would say is this. Let me clarify a couple things the way these crowd dynamics are going to work. If you use a melee attack, since we've been using cleave rules, you can, basically just roll damage, and then I will take that off of the crowd. If you do range, though, you're only essentially going to do 1 point of damage because you would just kill one person. So I know that sucks for the range folks, but that's how it would work realistically. So just to put it in perspective, and this is a crowd of just people, like they essentially are so low in hit points that you don't have to roll to hit. They will die if you attack them. But there are 100 of them.
Okay, I'm going to cast Web, 20-foot cube.
Oh, okay, cool.
And I'm just trying to hit as many of them as I can.
You definitely can. Where do you want that to go?
I mean, I guess we'll just do there.
Just right in the center. Okay. I'll say that 20-foot cube, I mean, that's a lot of people. Let me do this really quick. This is roughly a 20-foot cube.
Oh,
maybe a little bit bigger.
Okay, cool. It's that big. Awesome.
Maybe it's a little smaller than that. It's probably more like that.
So let's do this because I know it's going to happen on Aize's turn. So can you move it more north so that there'll be a section that I can web and a section that you can fireball?
So like that?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So... The web bursts outwards. How does it look when you cast web? Are you, yeah?
Yeah. So he throws. Looks like a spider, like an iron spider. He throws it out there, and it lands, and then kind of skitters, and then explodes into webs.
Web sprays out everywhere. And yeah, I mean, I would say that is a solid. I'll just call it, yeah, like about 40 people get incapacitated right now. They're all being stuck by the web, just unable to move, so I will, for now, they're kind of trapped there.
You guys stick around.
Oh my god. Okay, Glum, anything else?
That is my turn. Let's see. Bonus action for Scott, I guess nothing. That's good.
Okay, so you sit and watch. Okay, so whoosh, webs burst out. 40 people are suddenly trapped in the webs, trying to pull themselves free to get to you, all screaming and kind of writhing at the mouth, and it takes us to Aize. Aize, what would you like to do?
I hate this.
This is a tough situation. Yeah.
I mean, if they're mind controlled, they're not responsible for their actions. But on the other hand, they're determined to kill us. And I don't have any non-lethal spells. Note to self, Archive.
Oh, yes.
Whatever it takes to acquire a sleep spell.
Oh, I'm sure we could do that, yes.
And Glum, you're wrong. I'm not going to use fire.
I'm going to use ice.
I'm going to use ice.
Okay. Where would you like to drop it?
Hang on. I'll post it in BTT. I'll drop the ice storm for 23 points of damage.
Oh, you're doing ice storm. Oh my goodness. Okay.
It's 20 foot radius, but it will turn the terrain into difficult terrain.
Okay.
Until my turn.
Okay. So it is a 20 foot radius. It is essentially a fireball. Okay. You can get essentially the entire room with that.
I do not want to get Shiri or any other party members.
Okay, so I would say if you drop it there, I'll say that I kind of have to wing it, so 23 points of damage. Okay, yeah, I'll just apply the damage to the crowd, so 23 points as... Aize, you watch. What does your ice storm look like as it suddenly forms in this room?
It's a column of light shines down from the ether, and it starts basically pelting down freezing rain and hailstones, and they just batter everything in its path.
And you do indeed see these probably golf ball sized, if not larger, hailstones come... streaking down from the ceiling above, slamming into this crowd, and you just watch as people just drop, 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 and you hear cracks of bone and people just going limp. As multiple people are taken down from that. Anything else for you, Aize, as that entire area is now... Oh, I need to roll dex saves for a couple things here, but anything else for you, Aize?
I'll do advance archive into the room and park her over Shiri so that I get a better look at the place.
Okay.
And then I will make sure that I am... Actually, I'm not moving at all, no.
You're not moving at all?
Oh. Well, hang on. Sorry, let me check one thing. I think I have to maintain a certain distance to the elemental to maintain control. But I can look that up. I'm not moving. I'm
okay. Perfect. Does anything else happen with Ice Storm if somebody fails the save? Or just they take full damage?
I'm sorry, can I look it up? Or actually, I'll put it in BTT.
Okay.
It always makes things easier. You usually know stuff I don't know. There you go. Mm-hmm.
Doesn't look like I think it's just damage. Okay, cool. Perfect. So awesome. The crowd is being pelted by these stones of hail, and that entire area is difficult terrain. As a result, the crowd has thinned out enough at this point that moving through it will not count as difficult terrain anymore. Had you not thinned the crowd out, this entire area would have been difficult terrain with all of these people. But there are enough people being held by the web and being eliminated by the ice storm that it no longer counts as difficult terrain. Aize, as your turn comes to an end, let me check something here.
Sorry, Nathan, I did find it. It's 90 feet is the range.
90 feet, okay, cool.
Under elemental.
Cool. Rin, you are up.
Well. I don't have too much better of a plan other than waiting to see what Aspen does before I act. So I'm just gonna go right behind Aspen and just say, just follow you, Captain.
Okay, cool. Are you gonna hold an action?
So that's what she's doing. Her and Bert are gonna just hold action until Aspen goes.
Okay, sounds good. What is your held action?
I'm waiting to shoot for any of the mob that's going to come up towards us.
Okay.
If that means her going into the crowd.
Okay, cool. All right, that takes us to Aerolith. Aerolith, don't think she's used this today, so she will use it now. I don't think she used this. Yeah, she used this in the... Oh god, I can't remember. Yeah, I think she used this in the other fight. Yeah, she will... she'll call out to you, Aspen, and she's going to use her her leadership ability to give you a D6 to... you can use it to roll on any attack roll or saving throw. So she's going to... she's going to turn to you, pat you on the back, and be like, You are an amazing warrior. I actually truly mean that. You're really quite sexy when you go out there and fight, so you got this. You're gonna do great. So you get a D6 to all your attack rolls and saving throws.
Okay, now I have a question. Aize, do I have to make the save if I go into that? Into your ice storm? I think so, right?
Why not? Before you go, Aspen, two individuals in the crowd are kind of pushing through with intent. They seem to be wearing robes that are a bit more put together than the rest of the crowd. The rest of the crowd just all look like fisher folk, average folk of the size. But you see these two individuals in robes that are pushing forward, and you can see scrawled on their robes the design of the swirling symbol of Thera's Doom. And these two individuals are going to come striding forward. So this is difficult terrain, correct? So they can only move 15 feet as they come striding forward.
And I have a question. You said we can see this creature that is dangling in the nets above us, above the pit
of
murky water?
You can just make out, at the back of the room over here, there is something dangling, a big fish-like creature being suspended by ropes.
In that case, I was gonna go over there.
Well, but first,
I'm not anymore.
First,
okay.
No, no, it's fine. These two individuals, it is their turn, so they're going to stride forward just before your turn, Aspen, as you get this little boost of confidence, and they come striding through, and they're kind of scanning across, trying to see past Cherry, and they are going to, yeah, they're both going to. Cast Eldritch Blast. So this is going to be four Eldritch Blasts that come streaking through all of you, through the crowd, going straight for Aize. So here we go. So natural one, a nine. So
that's why I'm hidden behind a water elemental in the back.
Yeah, I mean, none of them hit. I don't think a 16 will hit, right, Aize?
16? Hold on one sec. Oh, crap, this thing again. Okay, sorry. I should really write this down. I have major armor on, but it never keeps track of this.
Oh, that's okay, yeah.
So my base armor class is 13 plus my dexterity modifier.
Okay.
So my AC is 16.
16, okay, so meets it, beats it. It will hit you unless you know.
I will throw a shield spell.
Okay, so poof, it blasts off and they kind of, as they're getting pelted by these hailstones and kind of trying to shield their faces, but that is their turn, taking us to Aspen.
Yay. Okay, I thought I wasn't going to be able to do this. I am going to cast this spell. Slow.
Ooh.
Ooh.
And that is a 40-foot cube, and I can get up to 6 creatures. So I think I can catch that one in the back as well.
The fish hanging from the ceiling?
Yeah.
Okay.
And that is a DC 17 wisdom save. Yeah, wisdom save.
Wisdom save, okay. They both fail, the two cultists. So suddenly they are slowed down. They no longer, what does it do? They no longer can take reactions, right? Yeah, can't use reactions. And they can only do an action or bonus action, not both. Wow. Damn, okay.
And their speed is halved again,
oh
so I don't
God.
Know
so
what that means. And they have
5 feet.
They have a negative penalty to the, negative 2 penalty to AC and dexterity saving throws.
Jeez. Yeah, so they can only move 5 feet inside the ice storm. As they suddenly, what does it look like when you cast slow, Aspen?
I think, I think I kind of, you see me cut my hand and I kind of take that blood and I kind of, is that it? What is material component for this?
Oh, it's
a drop of molasses.
But it can
but
be blood, that's
fine. I substitute the molasses for my blood, and I kind of, knowing that these are Therese Doom followers, I kind of call out to my mother and ask her to like convert this for me. And as I throw it out, it kind of just, it kind of comes up like a force field and I hit everyone that I can.
Nice, yeah. As you flick your hand out, you all watch as the spray of blood sort of ejects out from Aspen's hand and then sort of becomes coagulated and goopy as it kind of slows down and then clings to the creatures that she targets. These individuals now have these kind of spidery tendrils of coagulated blood coursing across their body as they're being restrained. The thing at the back, the blood sort of jets out towards it and then just kind of drops to the floor, seeming to not be able to connect, like there wasn't a creature there.
Okay.
All right, that, Aspen, anything else for you?
It says also, if the creature attempts to cast a spell with the casting time of one action, it has to roll a d20 on an 11 or higher. The spell doesn't take effect until the creature's next turn.
Do cantrips count? I guess it's a spell. Oh boy.
I will leave that up to you. You do with that whatever you want. But that's what I will do. And I just look back to Rin now.
Okay. Oh, Rin. Okay. Yeah, Rin, you have your held action. What would you like to do?
So, first of all, I know we're kind of just, like, arranged on the table like this, but is there going to be any issue with me shooting with the water elemental right there?
So, since you have sharpshooter, no. You are able Yeah.
Yeah, I'm like, I remember you had something, but I wanted to make sure.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
Just right... All right, so I'm assuming the casters of the Eldritch Blast are like visible enough to me. I know it's just the whole crowd, but just for the sauce of it, Rin points out to those two do for
okay.
her two shots.
Okay, so your two shots on those two individuals. So go for it, roll your attacks. Yep, that definitely hits. That one will not hit. So you hit one of them for 16 points of damage as the arrow courses through the air and slams into the chest of that individual. It's odd. You see them, like, react in a quick moment when they get struck, and then it's like they get caught in the slow spell and start to... all right. Anything... that was your held action, Rin.
Yeah.
And Aspen, yeah?
I also have the bird, but I don't know if that... Also.
I don't... That's a good question. I don't know if you can hold Bert's action.
I mean,
Bert is a bonus action to
use. So... Also, he's a bird, so it's not going to hurt my feelings if you don't let me.
Yeah, I think, unfortunately, just because the way it works, Bert has to be a bonus action on your turn, so, yeah, for balance. Okay, Aspen, anything else on your turn?
I can quicken that. I'm going to quicken that.
Okay.
I'm gonna quicken that and spend my two sorcery points, and Eldritch Blast right back at one at each of them.
Okay, go for it.
First one.
Let's see what the first one is.
Hold on. The first one is a 20 to hit.
Yeah, that definitely hits.
Oh, I rolled a one. Damn. Okay. Second one is. 28 to hit.
Okay, and is this split up between the two of them?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm hitting. I'm throwing one out at each.
Okay. Yeah. You slam into each of them. And they're looking real hurt, but they're still standing. Anything else?
Yeah. That is all I can do.
Okay. At the end of your turn, Aspen, Rin, Glum, Aerolith. You all suddenly feel a large thud from below you on the wood. And Aiza, you see the wood bow upwards and creak and moan. And then in a split second, you watch as all of the wood shatters and your companions drop into a hole below. All four of you, go ahead and make dex saves to try to catch any semblance of a lip that is next to you. Okay, so Rin, you plummet down.
Can I give her my inspiration?
No, you mean Aerolith? No, that is just for you.
So, Scott and Glum are not going to try and catch a lift, and I will cast Featherfall on the two of us, and Rin and anybody else that doesn't make it.
Before you do, well, this is happening so fast. Okay, cool. So. You cast Featherfall. You immediately, your momentum is halted, and you gently drift. What did you get at? Who are you casting it on? Anyone who doesn't make it?
Yeah, because I believe it goes up to like six characters.
Okay, so let's see if Aspen and Aerolith make it.
I got a 23.
So you make it, Aspen. And Aerolith, deck save. Aerolith fails. So. Do you let it go off on Aerolith as well, Glum?
Yeah, I'll save her as well.
Okay. So you cast the spell, meaning you'll just gently drift down to whatever awaits below, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so as you...
Luckily it's not a pit of acid.
Yeah, you cast the spell and immediately slow down, and within probably less than a second, you feel yourself splash into water. You probably fell maybe 6 feet.
Okay.
It wasn't that far. But as you splash down into the water, you now see that you are underneath the floorboards of this hallway, and it is a large kind of circular grotto of stone with about 6 feet of clearance between the water surface and the bottom of this building. And there is something moving below you, something big. And you see a large claw come up out of the water and go straight for, it'll go straight for you, Glum. Up out of the water. This is going to be two attacks on you. And Aspen, you've caught the lip, so how tall are you? You're not 6 foot, are you?
No.
Okay, so your feet are just above the surface of the water, but you're kind of hanging there. So this is on you, Glum. Two attacks.
Okay.
23 to hit.
Shield spell.
Next one comes in. 21 to hit. So as these two pincers come up out of the water and try to grab onto Glum, Rin, two more come for you. You notice there's now two creatures in this pit with you. An 8 to hit Rin and a 13 to hit Rin. So both those miss, I'm assuming. And then the third...
Oh, sorry. It would have been disadvantage on both attacks, but the second one... Yeah, actually it's disadvantage on both attacks. So that's going to miss.
For, right? For you?
Yeah, because you... So remember, I have the...
Yeah, so the first one. So the first one was a 23 and a natural 20. So the 23... was the first attack.
Oh, yeah, 23 and a 20. Okay, got it.
I know, cool. It's a disadvantage.
So, yeah, okay, great. So I still cast a spell, and, yeah.
Okay.
Perfect.
So both of them miss Rin, and then the last one is, it's going to go for Aerolith, because Aerolith fell in the water. So, sorry, Aerolith.
So, Scott's going to go ahead and use his reaction to cause disadvantage against that attack.
For Aerolith, okay. So, as Scott... gets in the way of this large pincer trying to go for Aerolith. Oh my god, I rolled two natural 20s!
Oh my god.
So Aerolith, immediately you just watch this claw dart out of the water and Scott tries to bite on to stop it, but it just clamps onto her and pulls her beneath the surface and she disappears with a gurgle. She's going to take some damage from that. She will take, wow, 18, okay, so 18 points damage, and then something else happens under the water that none of you can hear. You just see bubbles coming up and kind of a muffled as she starts screaming, and she needs to make a con saving throw. And fails, and the bubbles stop suddenly. Okay, so let's see. We have Aerolith, Glum, and Rin are all in a different room now, so I need to move you guys. And Aspen, you are just barely clinging on to the lip there, with your feet kind of dangling over the water. Okay, so you guys are down in the pit with these creatures as they are trying to pull you in deeper. And Scott as well is down there with you. So let me move. And I guess Bert is a bird, so he probably just fluttered up and is kind of like freaking out just above. Okay, that takes us to the end of the round. So at the end of the round, the crowd gets to go. The entire crowd, I think they come running and start leaping over the pit towards Aiyize and Aspen. A bunch of them start stamping on your hands, Aspen, as you're trying to hold on, just smashing your hands, screaming at you. A whole mess of people come charging and jumping across the pit towards you, Aiyize, and they come spilling into the room. I need Aspen and Aiyize to make...
Sorry, I just wanted to point something out.
Yeah.
That is difficult terrain.
Oh, you're right.
That was
okay.
Why I didn't use a fireball.
Yeah. That is a really good point. Okay, I will say then that only a small handful of people, because this entire room is filled and it doesn't quite get the edges there. So I'll say that, let me find my notes here. On the way I was running this, let me see. Okay, yeah, so I'll do this. About probably 24 people, maybe a little less, are able to get across and start running at all of you. So Aspen and Aiyize, I need you both to make, these are essentially, I need you to make an athletics check or an acrobatics check, your choice, as you're trying to, avoid these individuals from grabbing onto you, and you, in your case, Aspen, on trying to crush your fingers and make you drop into the water. Okay, Aize, you manage to shove them off, and you are not being held by them as they're all trying to grab you and pull you to the floor. And Aspen, you are able to deftly kind of shift off to the side as they try to crush your fingers. So that was the crowd. Taking us to the top of the round, which is Glum. So Glum, the creatures below you, you can't really see them. This is like, it's dark down here in murky water. I mean, if you dive below the surface, you'll be able to see them. But from the surface, it's kind of hard to see them.
Okay. Stand, protect the ranger. And then I'm going to swim down so I can see them.
Okay.
I think I would like to move there as I go down.
Yeah. So you dive down probably about 10 feet or so and immediately see these massive shapes of these strange crustacean-like creatures below you, all kind of trying to reach up to your companions. And you see one of them has Aerolith clutched in its claw, and there's these big tentacled sort of proboscis coming out from underneath the shell that are wrapped around Aerolith.
Okay. Are they standing on the bottom or swimming?
Good question. They are... they are... swimming. Okay. So you swam... I'll say you had to swim down at least 10 feet to get to them.
All right.
No. You know what? Sorry. Yeah. You swim down 10 feet and you can see that they are indeed like standing on the bottom, like lobsters. They're kind of down on the muddy bottom.
Okay. And then I will, yeah, I guess that's it. Okay. So I will, just point, my old crossbow at the one right beneath us.
Okay.
And and I'm doing my usual, it's kind of has a lot of kickback, so my accuracy isn't great, but I'm always using my sharpshooter now. Let's do it. Should be this one. I can't read it as well. I'll be able to tell you 1 second. Here we go. Yes, this one. Okay. Here we go. First one.
13 misses it. Boom! Off the hard shell of this creature.
Again.
Natural 20, nice.
All right, so that's more. that's gonna be 22 points of damage.
Sorry, which one are you attacking? The one that's on...
Right beneath us?
On Rin?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So, and sorry, 22?
Yep.
Nice.
How hurt does it look?
Not that hurt.
Okay, I'll just fire it again.
Okay.
Okay.
That's two natural.
Look at that! Look at that!
Wow, dice gods are in your favor. So how much?
24 more.
24 more points of damage. Nice.
And I'm gonna go ahead because these things are obviously hella tough, and we can't have them all attacking us all the time. So when I hit it, the last one, it sticks into it, and you know that kind of smite type ability I have that goes tick tick tick, boom, and explodes. Or 2d8. Using that, I can use that one more time after this.
Nice.
6 more points.
Nice. An explosion goes off, and you see some of the armor has cracked a bit now, and there's sort of this kind of black liquid clouding the water.
And
yeah.
I want to move down so I'm the more obvious target.
Okay. Wait, did you swim over to where your token is? Because that would provoke.
No, I don't know why. I don't know why it's over there.
Okay.
So let's see. I guess like that. Well, I can't really go in the middle.
No, I get you. Yeah. So you, but you, do you want to? So
I want to go down. I want to swim down. So I'm a more obvious target for you guys.
So you don't have a swim speed, correct?
No, nothing more than normal. So I'd be.
Okay. So you swim 15 feet down. Because you have a 30-foot move, right? Okay, so 15 feet down, and you are like essentially eye level with these creatures that are like under the water.
And then Scott is going to swim right in between Rin and I. So he could do the disadvantage ability on either of us.
Perfect. Cool. Anything else for you, Glum?
Nothing, sir.
Okay. Aize, it is your turn, and you are... Oh! Did Cherry get to go last time at the end of your turn? Did you want... I mean, Cherry...
No. I mean, I was hoping that she'd stop some people from running into the corridor. That was kind of the reason I put her there.
Right. Yes, yes. Okay. Yeah, sorry. There was a lot going on.
Oh, no problem.
Okay, but yeah, regardless, it is your turn.
The only people she can reach are the crowd. I told her not to move. I kind of wanted her to block the corridor.
That's a good point. I'll say this then, Aize. I mean, you did succeed on your save, so you're good to go. I'll say that only Aspen was the one where they were able to kind of push past Cherry but not get to you. So you currently are unaccosted in the hallway.
All right, can her slime attacks? She has melee attacks. Can she reduce their numbers?
Oh, yeah, so it's melee attack. So just go ahead and roll damage. You don't have to roll the hit, and I will reduce the total on the crowd.
That's one hit for 15 points, and her second hit for 11 points.
Oh, wow. Yeah, so with two massive many people are crushed and just...
Are there still people on Aspen trying to stamp on our fingers?
You know what? Actually, with that, all of the people that were trying to stamp on Aspen's fingers are crushed. They're all eliminated.
Well, it's the start of the round, so the ice storm difficult terrain is gone.
Oh, okay, cool.
The web is still there, though, and is that guy standing in it?
Oh, shit. yes, he is.
Yeah. If they move... Well, I mean, you probably didn't realize it.
I didn't realize it, but I did it. So, sure. Yeah, he was distracted by all the chaos and just stumbled right into the web, and he slowed.
All right. I look down. All right, I'll move up a bit. Look down in the hole. I can't move up. Ah, that's awkward. Can I see down into the hole from where I am?
Yes, you can.
Who am I? Is that Bert?
What's That's Bert, yeah.
Okay, yeah. All right, I'll look down in the hole. What do I see?
You look down into the hole and you see like water bubbles and chaos of water, and you see Rin bobbing at the surface of the water, but that's it.
All right. Everybody got a water breathing spell in the morning when I woke up, so that no one can drown.
Yes.
Okay, good. Well, there's two of them. And they did try to freaking bolt me, so... No, I'm gonna save some stuff here. We will, I will flame bolt this guy.
Okay. I think it's at advantage, I'm assuming. Or no, they just have a reduced AC, that's what it is. Which guy were you flame bolting?
The one not in the web.
Okay, for a 12 to hit, that hits because they have the reduced, it's a -2, right, Aspen?
Yes.
Okay, so 8 points of fire damage.
And then I tell Sherry, avoid the web, my dear, and kill this guy.
Okay, she will come spilling forward. And go ahead and she can make her attacks.
She'll do two slams on him. I figured maybe it'd be a good idea to clear this place out before we go dumb. Might be a good idea to clear these idiots out before we go dumb.
I'm just hanging there. I've been in this situation too many times.
Yeah, 9 will not hit.
Climb again.
21 definitely will hit, and 9 points of damage. He is crushed.
And I just tell Aspen, I can featherfall you.
I want to get that second guy before we go down. We should clear this place out before we go help. I think Airlift got pulled under.
I was. She can't drown, so there's that. But I believe, yes, we should finish these two off and then go help the others.
Okay.
I would try to haul you out, but my arms are as thick as
pipe. No, I would just fall in. I'm okay. Thank you.
All right. That'll be my action for the round.
Okay. Sounds good. Sorry, let me check something. Yeah, okay. That was your turn. Okay. Yeah, I think that is... Okay, the water below you, Aspen and Aize, and Rin, you suddenly feel the water itself almost, it's weird, it almost reminds you of Cherry. It kind of like bubbles outwards into almost like a pseudopod, and then suddenly... shoots upward like a torrent and lashes out to Aspen and Aize. Both of you make strength saving throws for me.
Ah, there's strength.
Okay. Yes.
You meant charisma, right?
Yeah, I'm straight charisma. Oh! Well...
All right, looks like we got a natural one and a 10. So, Aize and Aspen, you both are overwhelmed by this tide of water that slams into you, knocking you prone, and then you suddenly feel it surge backwards and pull you with it, and it pulls both of you down into the grotto.
Can I react to this?
Yeah. Well, I mean, if you have a reaction, what kind of reaction do you want to do?
One sec. Because I haven't used a reaction this round yet.
Yep.
Let me check this, sorry.
Is it a fireball reaction spell?
No, Misty Step is not reaction.
Oh yeah, it's bonus action. Yeah. Bonus action. And again, just to be clear, it is only about 6 feet down, so you're not going to take any damage from the fall, but you do get pulled down into the grotto with everybody else, both of you.
Oh, the key thing is I took no damage.
You took no damage, but you are pulled down into the grotto. Alright, that was that. Rin, you are up.
Yeah, so one thing, I hate to mention it, but I want to be fair. What happens to Bert? Is he also a victim of that weird splash thing? Or is he just hovering?
Yeah, actually, yeah. Bert will get... So make a strength saving throw for Bert.
So we're not like three turns in and you're like, wait a minute.
No, wait a second. So yeah, strength save for Bert.
Yeah. I love being fair. It's so rewarding. All right.
Bert dodges out of the way without issue as the water surges up towards Bert. All right, Rin, you are up. Bert is still up top.
All right. All right, so, same thing with the swimming. I'm not sure, how far would she need to swim down in order to see what's going on?
Oh, I mean, she can swim...
Or is it just as long as...
Yeah, she can swim 5 feet down and would be able to see the shapes of all the creatures below.
All right, so Rin's going to start by targeting... I'm so sorry. I still forgot your name. I was just going to try to help the one I keep forgetting.
Uh-huh. Okay. You're going to try to help her? I'm not going to help you with her name, but yeah, you can help her.
I'm so sorry. I forgot your name.
If you swim down and look, I mean, you see she is essentially, like, Like, yeah, she's almost stiff, and like her eyes are wide and bug-eyed, and she looks like she can't move as these tentacles are wrapped around her.
She's going to declare favored foe, so on the second, if she gets her second shot, that'll come into effect, but first let's aim for the first shot. 18 minus 3.
Let me double check. That does not hit, unfortunately. I was also just about to check, if I remember correctly, when you're fighting underwater,
bows are at disadvantage.
Yeah, bows are at disadvantage. So you are shooting these at disadvantage. So that first shot misses regardless, but the next shot you take has to be at disadvantage.
Got it. It's the exact same
thing. So both shots are unable to penetrate through the armor. Anything else for you, Rin?
For bonus action, which won't come into effect until she starts shooting again. This is for the next turn, I believe. So she's going to cast Ensnaring Strike. It has worked in the past, but let's hope it works today. And that'll just be for the next time she shoots.
Okay, cool. So you get ready to use Ensnaring Strike on one of these creatures. Perfect. Anything else for you, Rin? Mm-mm. Okay, cool. Aerolith is... Let me see how this works. Okay, so she's going to make another saving throw to see if she can break free of this. Here we go. Con save. Ooh, she fails. So she is still paralyzed by this thing. Wow, there's a huge gap in the initiative orders here. It's wild. Ooh, you know what? I think... Fascinating. Is that right?
As you're looking, a quick shout out to my buddy Skagwater. He's from the TikTok, and he cosplays as a Palbarian Minotaur. Super cool guy.
Oh man, that's awesome. I would love to see that that art. I would love to see that cosplay. Interesting. Okay. Is it going to do that? I think it will. Aspen, so you and Aize are prone, so you have essentially gone under the water and are kind of like trying to get your bearings. In this murk and muck, with the kind of sound of the water burbling around you, you suddenly hear a voice creep into your mind, this strange, oh, how delicious. Make a wisdom saving throw for me.
Oh, that was horrible. Okay. Wisdom?
Yes.
11. I will use my d6. From Aerolith.
23.
12.
Okay. And Aize, this is only on Aspen, so not affecting you. And... Aspen, you get a 12.
As a reaction, because I have not used mine yet, right? Only Scott's. Not even Scott's. Anyway, Glum says, "Don't let it happen." Oh, sorry. He's underwater. Don't let it happen. And I will use my ability to give her a +3 to her saving throw as a reaction.
Okay.
I do that 3 times per rest.
Okay, so you had a 12, so that'll bring it up to a 15. Unfortunately, it does not help this call out from Glum, as whatever is piercing into your mind, this strange voice, and you feel a chill run up your spine, and then suddenly you just get this flash of intense pain in your head and an image of just like wet tendrils sort of like encompassing your entire vision as they're pulling you into a black abyss. And you are going to take 10 points of psychic damage as this happens. Okay.
Do I have to make a con check?
Yes, you do, to hold up the slow. That's right.
This is DC 10?
DC 10, yeah.
29.
Nice. You totally hold that spell, so those guys up top are still slowed. So that was the end of Aerolith's turn, taking us to the cultists up top. The one guy who was still alive. You said it's not difficult terrain anymore, but he did walk into the web. So what happens if he walks into the web?
Saving throw. As if he just got hit by the spell.
Okay, so this would have happened, I think, before the slow spell, because he would have walked into it. So what kind of save is it?
It is a 15.
Strength?
Dex. Oh, well, that's a good question. So it's a strength to break out and a dex to avoid.
Well, he rolled a natural 11 regardless. Okay, so yeah. So he stumbled into the web and it got stuck by it. So now he will, I guess, use his one and only action to try to break free of said web.
Yes.
And make a strength saving throw.
Yes.
And gets a 15. But there's something about slow with strength and dex saves. I think it's like...
It's not as dex save, unfortunately, to get out. It's a minus two armor class and a minus two dex saves.
Oh, okay. So yeah, so he breaks free of the web, but is still only able to move 15 feet because of the slow. And is slowly trying to run towards you all. In the web.
He can make the save again at the end of each of his turns.
Oh, okay, cool. What kind of save? Wiz?
Wiz 17.
Oh, wait, he gets a... Is he proficient? No, he's... Oh, wait, I was rolling the wrong stat block. Hold on. Okay, yeah, it doesn't matter. Because they rolled natural one. Okay, great. So he's still slowed. Aspen, you are up.
So... am I currently like unable to speak right now?
No, you can speak and you can do you suddenly come to your senses and you were fine. You can see about 10 feet about 10-ish feet below you, these shapes of these big crustacean creatures, and you can just make out one of them is crushing Aerolith.
Okay. I'm gonna do a Toll of the Dead on that, the one that's crushing Aerolith.
Okay.
DC 17 Wisdom.
DC 17 Wisdom, okay.
Has this one been hurt?
No.
DC 17
Wisdom. 15, so failure. Go ahead and roll that damage.
It takes 13 points of necrotic damage.
The brand flashes across its body. Okay. Anything else?
Yeah, I'm gonna convert a second level spell into sorcerer points.
Okay.
All right. Yep. That's all I want to do. Oh, I would like to stand up as well.
Yeah. So you swim. I'm realizing I don't think you can actually be knocked prone underwater. I'm not sure how that works. But yeah, you are swimming. Do you want? I guess the question is: do you want to stay underwater or swim up, just to the surface?
Where's Rin?
Rin is underwater, about 5 feet below the surface.
And where's Glum? Is he like further?
Glum is like 15 feet down. You can. I don't even know if you actually see Glum because he's kind of behind one of these big creatures.
Okay. Yeah, no, I think I'm going to stay underwater.
Okay. Okie doke. Then if that is your turn, it is now all of the creatures below you, these big crustacean creatures. I'll start with the one that is currently holding on to Aerolith. It is going to just start to crush Aerolith with its pincer. Let me see. Yeah, here we go. So she is paralyzed. So I think This is at advantage, and I think if it hits, is it a critical? I think it might be a critical hit if it hits on a paralyzed creature. I forgot to look this up ahead of time. Hold on.
I can look it up for you.
Yeah, I'll look it up as well, and that hopefully one of us will get to it quickly. Okay.
I don't think you get crit, but I'm looking.
Paralyzed. The creature is incapacitated. Incapacitated. Incapacitated creature can't take actions or reactions. Okay. Attack rolls have advantage. Yeah. Okay, cool. Yeah. Oh, no, I was looking at petrified. I wasn't looking at paralyzed. Here we go. Paralyzed. Any attack that hits the creature is a critical hit if the attacker is within 5 feet of the creature. So, these will be critical hits. So, at advantage, critical hits. So, I think it's goodbye for Aerolith. Here we go. As you watch Aspen, Aerolith being crushed by the pincer, the tentacles wrapped around her, she is stiff, eyes wide, kind of shaking in pain, and the pincer starts to crush down for 15. Where is her AC? That is just her AC. So, 10 points of bludgeoning damage, which is, I believe, automatically increased to 2d6. It's 12, 7. Okay, 16 points of bludgeoning damage. And then the other pincer comes as she is, you see blood starting to hemorrhage out from her, and the other pincer just comes and wraps around her face and... and she goes limp as it just crushes down. You hear a loud snap under the water and she goes limp. So she's gone. The other ones are going to come up and try to grab onto all of you up top. So I'm gonna go, let's see. We got definitely one on Glum. Let's start with you, Glum.
Yeah.
So these are at disadvantage.
Awesome.
13, so that misses, and an 8, so that misses as it tries to snap at you. This one is going to go up towards Rin.
Am I interposing at all because I went down or no?
You got one of them. You got one of them to focus on you. These are big creatures, so. Yeah. This one's going to go for Rin.
First one would be disadvantage because of Scott.
Okay, so Scott. Underwater, slams the pincer out of the way, and the next one is a natural 20 for a 26 to hit you, Rin. Rin, you take 16 points of bludgeoning damage, and you are grappled by the claw, and you watch as a piece of the kind of chitinous armor on this thing, where the face would be, there's these sort of like antennae kind of twitching in your face. It sort of peels open, and you watch as these tentacles sort of come sliding out and wrap around you. I need you to make a constitution saving throw for me.
Yeah.
19.
Heck yeah.
19, you succeed. You resist this course of poison that shoots through your body. And the last one is going to go for you, Aspen. 24 to hit.
Yeah, I don't even think I'm gonna shield that because 24 would be my AC.
Okay.
So yeah, I'll take the hit.
You are grappled and take 8 points of bludgeoning damage as it pulls you down. And again, those tentacles peel out from under the armor and wrap around you. I need you to make a con save.
26, and then can I just drop concentration whenever?
If you want, yeah.
Yeah. Slow is gone.
Okay, slow is gone. And the other attack is a 12 to hit, so that will miss. But you are being clutched by this creature, and you resist the poison, and the slow is gone. Okay. Taking us to Glum.
All right. So the one that grappled Rin is... not the one that I shot.
The one that grappled Rin is not the one that you shot. It's the one that's under Aize. That's the one that grappled Rin.
Okay.
So Rin, you are grappled.
Let
me just do this.
Okay. I'm going to blast away, just hope I get some good rolls on the one that's already hurt, because the longer there's four of these, the more attacks they're going to get. So, here we go. Oops. One sec. Right spot. And use my usual. Expect some misses here. Okay, that's a miss.
Okay.
Boom. They have 60 normal class?
Yeah. There you go. I mean.
Nice. Okay, hit. 22.
Yep, that hits.
15.
15 points. Sorry, and this is the one that's grappling Grin, Rin?
No, the one that's hurt.
Okay, cool. Yeah. So sorry, how much damage on that one?
That is 15.
15, okay.
Last one will miss.
Okay, yeah. It's looking hurt. There's definitely like a lot of fluid leaking out of the puncture wounds that you put on its armor, but it's still standing. Anything else for you?
Yeah, Scott's gonna. Well, actually, he's kind of in between us. We can't really put him here. But yeah, he's still in between Rin and Blum.
Okay, cool.
That'll be it for the turn.
Okay, Aize, you are up.
I think I'm. Why can't I see a damn thing? All right, first thing first. Archive, get down here.
Ooh, yes, yes.
Archive comes floating down before you.
I can move
Archive, yeah.
Yeah.
Let me. Yeah, there you go.
Oh my goodness, gracious me. All right, there's four of them?
Yes. Oh yeah, you don't have dark vision, so you literally are just in darkness and can't see anything around you. You just feel the currents moving about.
Well, that's why I'm bringing Archive to me, because
yes.
He has that.
So suddenly Archive comes down before you, and then you hear,
Oh my word!
All right, there's four of them, and one of them's crushing Aerolith, and another one's crushing Mon Capitaine, and one of them is completely knocked. I can't put a fire. How high off the ground? Oh, no.
You are only 5 feet underwater, and they are 10 feet below you. No, they're only actually about 5 feet below you. These are big creatures. It seems that this entire space is about 20 feet deep, and they are down in the bottom of the grotto.
Okay. I'll drop the fireball set for cold on this side.
Okay.
Catching this guy and this guy. I can't catch all four without... Well, let's see. I should be able to catch them without... hitting Aspen.
Yes, you can just catch the edge of the two of them there, yeah.
And then I'll call out. Can I yell an instruction to Cheery as well?
Oh, that's a good question. Does it say that you telepathically are linked with them? If not, then I'm gonna say no.
All right, I will look that up.
I'm going to make these saves for these guys and see if they succeed on your fireball as it flash freezes the water in the area.
Well, here we go. I'll throw the fireball. Save some time.
Okay, one of them failed. One of them, I believe, succeeded with a 17.
27 points of damage on the fireball. Let me look up the Conjure Elemental.
Okay. 27 points. And the other one... wow, my brain. There we go.
All right. It is not telepathically linked, but it will listen to any verbal commands, and it doesn't require any action to do so.
Okay.
Am I under the water?
You are under the water. Yeah, I guess you could just swim up 5 feet and shout. Yeah.
Right. So I'll throw the ice ball straight up. Yell out, Jerry, kill that guy and then come down here.
Okay, yeah. Okay. So anything else on your turn before we go to Cheery?
I'm gonna... Jeez, this thing's right underneath me.
Oh, yeah. And it looks like it has a good reach on it.
Okay. no problem. I will use my bonus action this time, and I will Misty Step, and I'll use the Misty Step in my ring, not mine.
Okay, cool.
And I'll go back up top.
Okay, I'll move you over to the top here as you appear.
But I'll leave Archive there.
Okay, cool.
And that way I can see down in the hole, and I'm being very wary of any big water tentacle coming up to take me down.
Sounds good.
And the one that, did I kill the one on Aspen? Is it still up?
Oh no, it's fine. Sorry. Okay.
Sorry, boss.
All right. At the end of your turn, Aize, Cherry can go. And you told Cherry to kill that dude and then go down there. Okay, so Cherry is going to go ahead and make that attack. She brings it down on that guy. He's no longer slowed, so his armor class is back to normal. But I don't think it'll matter. Oh, natural one. Okay, he jumps out of the way. And that will definitely hit. Oh wow, he's barely standing as it crushes him. Just barely standing. Okay, that was Cherry's turn. Takes two. Okay. Interesting. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Aspen. You hear that voice again.
Oh, Lord.
it creeps back into your mind.
Hi. I would like you to be mine now. And join Therizdun with me.
Make a wisdom saving throw.
16.
Ooh, you just resist as you feel some presence pressing into your mind and trying to rip all sense of self from you. And then you hear,
no! You will be mine!
Okay. That was whatever that was. And as we come to the, let's let Rin go, and then we're gonna take a break. Rin, so you are being held by this lobster creature. You are unable to move. You can try to break free. That will take your action, but, yeah, what would you like to do?
Yeah, I was going to ask that. So it's to get out, it would take my entire action. But fighting, how is that affected by grappling?
So you're fine. When you're grappled, the only thing that applies to you is that you can't move. So all attacks are normal. Your bow, obviously, is at disadvantage because you're underwater. But yeah, if you were to do melee, it would be normal.
As much as I'd like to see what attacking it looks like, I'm going to just use my action to try to get out.
Okay, go for it. Make I think it's a strength saving. Hold on.
Alright.
You are grappled. Just go ahead and make an athletics check for me. Yes.
Alright.
Yes, athletics check. Oh yeah, that's right, because you're just grappled. So you make an athletics check, and then it makes a contested one. So here we go. Ooh, we got a 15. I don't remember what happens in contested rolls like that. I think
we say bygones be bygones, and then
like... Yeah, you both look at each other and go, "Oh, you're both very, you're very strong. I'll let you go." No,
I say the hero always wins.
Yeah, I was gonna say I think it's meets it beats it. So I think Rin, you are just barely able to. I don't know how you break free. It's got you clutched. Like, how are you breaking free of this thing?
Well, I'll say the one advantage she has is that she is on the smaller side, so she's able to kind of wiggle out. Perfect. Just from that.
Yeah, just wiggle free and it snaps shut below your feet and you kind of swim up above it a little bit. So that was your action. What else would you like to do?
I don't think Spurt will be very helpful here. So that's the end of it for me.
That's the end of it. Okay, anything for Bert or no?
Bert could dive in.
I don't know how far he could dive though for attacks, because he'd be diving like 10, 15 feet.
Yeah, I don't know, because I think it's your, I don't know, if you have a fly speed, I guess that doesn't apply, it's your walking speed, and his walking speed is 10.
Do you want to leave it until after the break?
Yeah, I mean, I think, I'll say this, because birds, there are birds, they can dive underwater, like that is a thing that they do. So
ospreys.
Yeah, exactly, ospreys. So I would say that Bert, I know he has a 10-foot walking speed, but with a dive down, I would say he could definitely get, we'll call it 10 feet down, and then with his 10-foot movement speed, he could get that additional 5 to get 15 feet down. So yeah, if you want to have Bert dive down, he could just barely reach one of these creatures and try to...
The follow-up question
is... He would not get flyby.
He wouldn't be able to get out of the water.
No.
Sorry that we just went through all that, because I'm just going to not send
okay,
him.
Okay, cool.
Sending a bird to 15 feet underwater and not having him come back out sounds like a bad idea.
Perfect. And right as we go on break here, the last thing that happens here is Aize, the crowd in the room has been decimated. There's still 25 people being locked in by the web trying to break free, but there is a collection of about 10 individuals that are still, they don't look like they are under their own free will, and they all simultaneously turn and see you across the pit and see an opening with Cherry currently smashing this one cultist down with her big watery fists, and they all come running and leap across the pit and are going to try to grab onto you. Please make a strength saving throw for me. A 1, okay. Well, it looks like you rolled a 2, or a 3. You rolled a 3 and got a 1. So Aize, if you were muted, are you going to do something? I can't hear you, you were muted.
Sorry, I'm muted. I'll burn a luck point.
Okay.
Where's my luck? Whatever. It just means I get to reroll and I have to take this roll.
Okay. Make sure you mark off that luck point. And yeah, you manage to push them off. They all seem to be, they're ripping at your clothing and trying to pull you and pull you to the ground and keep you from running away or moving. And they all are frantically trying to get at you. Taking us to the end, rated initiative count. Well, that actually would have happened at the very end. Whatever, it's fine. Let's go on break, because I need a moment to reset. But as Aize is being accosted by all these individuals and the rest of you are down below fighting with the strange lobster monsters, we're going to go on break and we will be right back.
Quick question, Nathan.
Yes.
It looks like Axel is Alex, wants to know what music you're using for the background.
Oh yeah, I put it in chat. So I grab from, ooh, that is super cool. Who is that? That's a Minotaur. What is that from?
Oh, well, I thought Eric said that his friend was a pallbearer Minotaur, so I drew one.
Oh my god, that's so cool.
It's a pallbearian.
Oh, but he's carrying, I thought you said pallbearer, because he's carrying a coffin on his back.
Oh, that's even...
Chris, keep it there.
Are you still there?
Keep it there. There we go. Just so that if he's still there, so he can see it. Hold it up again, Chris, so we can see it. That's so cool. Wow. That's awesome.
Yeah. Oh, it's got a pallbearer.
Yeah. That makes it even funnier.
I love it. All right. The music I put in chat. We are using tabletop audio is where I'm grabbing all this from, and the song that we're currently playing is called Escape from the Shadow. yeah. So thank you to Tabletop Audio. You guys make amazing music, and very thankful to be using it. Okie doke. Let us go on break. We'll see you all soon. Bye.
See you soon.
Where's the button? Okay, bye.
Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back. We're just going to jump right back into it because this is a big fight, and I feel like we got to use all the time that we have, so let's just get right into it. Okay. It is initiative count 20, and as a result, something is going to happen.
Everyone, I think something's gonna happen.
Okay, yeah, actually, so all of those, any individual that is in the water, so that is everybody except for Ayize, I need you to make a wisdom saving throw for me.
Who's doing this? What?
All of you need to make wisdom saving throws. Everybody. Except for Ayize. Okay, so Rin fails.
Is this a spell?
No.
Is this a mental, so hold on, let me check.
It is going to be yes, it is like a mental thing. It is targeting your psyche.
Well, it actually doesn't matter. Any wisdom saving throw is advantage. So,
oh, okay, cool, cool.
So
here
we go. Advantages.
Okay, that's a natural 20. So the only Rin, only you fail. All of you in the water suddenly feel kind of a presence in your mind, and all of you just hear this. and Rin, you suddenly get that piercing pain and see the writhing tentacles in darkness, and you take 7 points of psychic damage. All right, that was initiative count 20. The cultists up top, like barely holding to life, kind of stiffens up, trying to ignore the looming water elemental who's lifting its fist. No longer has slow on him, so he's going to extend outwards and... What can you do? I think it's just going to be Eldritch Blast, but let me double check. Yeah, it's just going to Eldritch Blast Ayize. So just two Eldritch Blasts out towards Ayize. 21 to hit. Ayize, does that hit?
I still haven't used my reaction, right?
Correct.
Shield spell.
Shield spell? 21 will, with a shield, a 21 will get blocked?
Yep.
Because your armor class is normally... 17. Oh, wow, oh, nice, sorry. Okay.
Armor class is 16 normally.
Well, then that would bring 21. It... Yeah, it'll bring it to 21, so then it'll still hit.
Hold on, let me look it up again.
It's a plus 5.
Mage armor is 13 plus 3. My base armor class is 16 plus 5. Oh, he's going to hit regardless. All
yes.
Right, fine. I'll pick it.
Okay, so you take 16 points of force damage as this Eldritch Blast slams into you. I need you to make a concentration check for Cherry. You have Warcaster.
I have Warcaster. Hang on, let me see if I can... Hold control... all right, so this is, what is it, a con saving throw?
Yes, please. You need a 10 or higher.
12? 14?
Oh, yeah, you're fine. Another Eldritch Blast for a 24 to hit, and you take 11 points of force damage on that one as it slams into you, and you need to make another concentration check. You need to get a 10 or higher.
21. Yeah.
You're fine. And you see this cultist kind of go limp and exasperated and sort of accepting their fate, taking us to Aspen.
So we can't tell where this voice is coming from, right?
Go ahead. I'll give you a free perception roll. But it is just coming from your mind. But you are starting to, like, look around this space. No, you have no idea.
I don't care enough.
Yeah, you are in pain. You are being clutched by this creature, and there's a lot of silt in the water, so it's kind of murky and hard to see.
How is everyone looking? Is everyone looking okay? Can I do what I want to do, or do I need to heal?
I think Rin's kind of messed up.
You're messed up? Okay, so... I'm going to lean over Saren. And I'm going to hit her with a second level cure wounds.
Okay.
I'm going to buy this page. Hold on 1 second.
Benefit of being hit near each other.
Oh, that's horrible. Actually, I get to do this now. I'm going to reroll that. I have Empower Healing. I'm gonna put it up there. So I get to spend one of my sorcery points to reroll. I'm definitely going to reroll that one.
Nice, okay.
What is this, a D8? Yeah, D8. Okay, so this is... 7. It's not much better, but it's plus 7, so that's 14 points of healing, Ren.
Nice.
I never roll good on D8s. And I'm going to quicken. No, I'm not. What am I going to do? I have a question. Am I sort of flanking with Glum on this guy?
Yeah, I'll give that to you. Yeah, yeah. Because Glum specifically positioned himself down to get in front of this thing. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I can't do anything else. That's it. That's all I can do.
That's all you can do. Okay. At the end of your turn, Aspen, you hear the voice again in your head.
All right, if you're not going to come with me, then I will take you.
Go ahead and make a wisdom saving throw.
I don't like this guy. I don't like this. Oh, no.
That's a failure.
Wait. I have favored by the gods.
Okay.
This might help.
How many times can you do that?
I did not use it in the last battle.
Okay, cool.
I get this back on every short rest or long rest.
Okay, cool.
So I've been saving it for this exact moment.
Oh no! You are unable to make a connection with your god, and you take only 10 points of psychic damage.
Okay. I think it's all right. Yeah. That is all I can do.
Okay. Excellent. That takes us to the lobster creatures. Okay, the one that was holding Aerolith just lets go and lets Aerolith's limp body drop to the floor. And it is going to turn and face you, Aspen, being held by its companion. And these two lobster creatures are just going to go at you, Aspen. So here we go. They are flanking. So this will be with advantage. Here we go. 22 to hit.
Ew.
Shield. 25 to hit. Does that still
get hits?
Yeah, hits. So you take 10 points of bludgeoning from that one. 24 to hit.
That hits.
10 more points of bludgeoning. And 15, so that misses. So as you are trying to deflect these attacks, the pincers are coming in trying to crush you. Let me check something about the... Oh yeah, so then the one that's grappling you, that's holding you, those tentacles once more reach out and try to grab around you. Make another constitution saving throw for me.
Oh
Yeah, you succeed. So you resist whatever poison is coursing through your body. Glum, well, let's see. First, let's do... Yeah, I'll do Glum. So this one's going to go for you, Glum.
Yep.
Just two attacks. 23 to hit. Oh, wait, no, disadvantage. So 7, that misses. And a 15, does that miss? That misses, yes. Yeah. Okay, and then the other one's going to go for Rin again.
First one disadvantage.
First one disadvantage for a 17 to hit Rin.
18 Arbogast.
Okay. It's deflected by Scott, and then it's going to come up with the next pincer for a 12 to hit. So that misses.
Nice.
Both of those miss.
Rin lives.
Oh, man. Okay, whatever. I already did it. Glum, you are up.
Okay. The only one looks like it might be dead is just the close to death is this
one. That
one's
looking hurt, yes.
That's the only one.
Yeah, not necessarily at death's door, but it is hurt. It is very hurt.
Yes. Alright.
These are big boys.
Yeah. We could use a water elemental about now. And then I'm going to fire 3 times with my pew pew crossbow.
Go for it. Oh man, 5, that misses. Oh no! And that one hits.
Wait, aren't we technically flanking?
That's a ranged attack, yeah. So 16 points of damage, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's still standing.
Let's add 2d8, because I probably won't kill it, but I'm going to use it anyway. I got one more.
You got one more? Okay. Boop, 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 boop. It is barely clinging to life with that. There is a huge chunk of armor missing. There's viscera coming out, but it is still clinging to life.
Okay. Guess that will be my turn.
Okay. Aize, you are up.
Okay, first off, I'm going to yell to Cherry, finish him and then get these idiots off me.
Okay. So you want Cherry to go first?
Yeah, she'll take her action first, and then I'll go.
Okay, so go ahead and roll that attack as she...
Bringing up Cherry. Go, Cherry, this. 19 to hit.
That definitely hits. And 11 points of damage. This guy is crushed. He's down.
And then have her come over to me and get these idiots off me.
So easy. She comes swimming over. And if you want her to do the slam attack, make the go ahead and just roll the damage.
Okay. Damage. Ooh, nice.
Oh my god.
18 points.
Yeah, they are all crushed instantly. And all that's left are the ones stuck in the web, and there's just bodies everywhere in this temple.
I'll take a step forward to the edge of the hole.
Mm-hmm.
Look down.
Mm-hmm. You
I'm
just
place the fireball exactly where I placed the last one.
Okay, so they will make saves.
Set for force this time.
Force damage, okay.
Not that it matters, but...
It's DC 17, right?
Yep.
Okay, so one of them made it, and one of them failed. Go ahead and roll that damage.
21 points.
21 points, okay. I said one of them made it. So this one will take... 10 points, and one of them failed. This one will take 21. The armor starts to crack on the one that's holding Aspen, but it's still standing.
Dang it!
When that goes off, all of you in the water, you suddenly hear a Alright, Aspen, or Aize, anything else for you?
Actually, can I have Cherry drop in the hole?
Yeah, sure. So she drops down into the fray.
Protect yourself, Cherry. Otherwise, you see that one that's holding Aspen? Heal him.
All right.
And that's my, and then I'll just stand there and look down, looking down.
Okay.
Archive's lighting my way. That's it.
Okay. Sounds good. Okay. Let's see here. Aspen and Rin. And I suppose Archive, let me see. Yeah, so Aspen, Rin, and Archive are able to see this. In this grotto, there is like a smaller, narrower cave that winds down and outwards to the west. And all of you see a dark shape kind of rise up out of the silt, kind of undulating and moving. There's a slight glint across something slick and shiny, and you can kind of hear coming through the water an abyssal phrase of something speaking. It's odd. It comes through. And whatever this thing is, it is casting a spell. So it casts a spell, and
counterspell. I'm sorry.
You're a counterspell. Okay.
I will counterspell it. Yeah.
Okay. So it fizzles out, and the sort of mass of darkness there in the tunnel shifts and looks at you, Aspen, and you hear in your head, "All right, let's make this more fun." Okay, I'm not gonna quite reveal it on the map, but there is the shape is right about here. Everybody got that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, Rin, it is your turn.
Awesome. Okay. So, just because I didn't clarify it last time, I'm going to have Rin swim up so she's 5 feet from the surface, so she can see everything, but is also just not at the lowest part.
But you're still under the water, right?
Still underwater.
Okay, sounds good.
Two normal shots, which will still be with disadvantage, but then I won't have to deal with that. -5 from sharpshooter. Going to be the same one that we have been trying to kill.
Oh, the one that Glum has been attacking? Okay.
Yeah.
Go for it.
Oh, wait. The disadvantage.
Disadvantage, yes. But they are normal shots. Okay.
I'll roll it again and just, then...
Yeah, roll it again and we'll take the damage from the first one. Okay, yeah. So you definitely hit.
Okay. So it's not +10. It's
so
just 7.
It's just 7 points of piercing. So with that first shot, Rin...
Oh, sorry. I thought it took all the tick marks.
Oh, it's fine. Go ahead. With that first shot, you let the arrow go, and it darts through the water and slams right into the top of the head of this thing, and it goes and goes limp and falls down onto the ground.
Yeah, we got one finally.
Goodness. All right. Then I'll remember to shoot with disadvantage this time. Now it's the one that's holding Aspen.
Okay, yeah, go for it. A 12 will miss.
I don't think it's
12. Yes. All right.
I just get like a small part of its tail. I'm like, got it.
Got a little piece of chitinous tail that flicks off. Anything else for you, Rin?
I'm just going to have... I'm trying to think of what's going on with the cultists above ground. I don't think any of them have been able to go as far as anywhere near the pit.
You
so,
have no idea, yeah. Where you
yeah.
Are. Yeah.
Yeah, so... Look how desperate am I. well... Yeah. I'm going to send Bert down, which is not my favorite option, but gonna try. Is this with disadvantage or
no.
So no, it'll be a normal attack, but like I said, this he won't get the flyby. So Bert is going to dive down and he will be where he is. Okay?
Alright.
Which one is he going for?
He's going to dive down.
Cool.
To where he sees Aspen. All my windows. And a 15's not gonna do anything.
15.
You have 18, I think. Right?
Sorry, a 15. No. That will not hit. No.
Yeah, okay. So now it's underwater.
All right. Is that it for Bert?
Yes.
Okay.
Because he can't swim up, I'm assuming.
Like within
the same round. Yeah.
No, he cannot, unfortunately. Cool. So, on initiative count 20, I need all of you to make intelligence saving throws for me.
Easy peasy.
All of us?
Yes, all of you.
I have advantage.
23?
Okay. And a 16. So, okay. So, only Aspen fails. Aspen. You hear the voice. Okay. Why don't you meet my friend? And from behind that dark shape, you see another shape. Suddenly, something large kind of down into the water from above, down the tunnel, like something plopped down from above. And you suspect that what you're seeing is where that pool was at the back of the temple. And it looks like something splashes in and bubbles rise up. And then with lightning speed, you watch as a massive shape comes rocketing down the tunnel. This huge shark comes swimming down straight at you, mouth agape, but you see that it is rotting and pieces of flesh are falling off. There are heads that have been stitched onto it of various humanoids that are stitched into its skin and are kind of flopping around as it swims towards you. And its large mouth comes straight up towards you and it manages to get right up next to you. As it gets up next to you, it snaps out towards you. And you take 4 points your arm and you feel some blood kind of as a teeth scrape against your arm, and you take 5 points of damage.
Okay,
next up is that guy's dead. Next up is Aspen. So you have this massive shark in front of you.
I misty step away.
You misty step away. Okay, where do you go?
I go right next to Aizé.
You go next to Aizé. Okay.
Yeah.
With a puff of light and energy, you appear next to Aizé.
Lord of mercy, you look rough, Captain.
Rough, not the word. And for my action,
yes,
I'm going to wait. Let me just see what the range is on. It's 60 feet, so I can see down still into the hole, right?
Yes, you can.
Okay, so was the one that was holding me before, was it hurt?
It was. It is now
okay.
Under the water, though, about 10 feet below, and the water is murky and mucky.
That's fine. I'm going to do Told and Dead.
Do you have to see the creature?
That is a good thing. Yeah, it says a creature you can see within range. So I cannot see the creature?
Make a perception roll.
If I can,
I'll let you do that.
If I can't see it, that's
I don't think
fine.
You can, to be honest. Yeah.
Yeah, so then I'll do... then I'll just Eldritch Blast. I'll just Eldritch Blast then.
Okay, so at disadvantage...
And this is... please, I hope that didn't go. Okay, disadvantage?
Because you're firing at the... I'm assuming you're firing at the creature below, right?
Yes.
Yes, that would be a disadvantage.
First one?
Because you cannot see it. Yep.
Okay.
First one?
13.
That will miss.
Okay. Second one? 13.
13. So both of those miss, unfortunately. Those of you below just see streaks of light from above. Anything else for you, Aspen?
Yeah, I just lay on the ground next to Ayuze. Puffing and puffing. All this blood coming out of me. I want to cry. But no, that's the end of my turn.
Okay. It's now all of the crustacean creatures' turns. I think two of them are going to go for Cherry, and the other one is just going to keep going for Rin. So here we go. We'll start with Cherry. Let's see. Cherry is kind of floating above them.
Cherry is armor class 14.
Class 14. Okay, they have a swim speed of 30. I mean, this thing is essentially... They very... Not the most graceful thing, but it kind of pushes off the floor of the muddy bottom and swims up into... it's kind of like above... Or like... No, I don't think it can get into a flanking position. No, it's fine. It can't. So it's just gonna swipe up with its claws. So here we go. Four attacks on Cherry. 17 to hit, so that'll be 12 bludgeoning damage.
She's resistant to bludgeoning damage.
Okay, so she takes 6. And she is a large or smaller creature. Can she be grappled, or is she immune to that condition?
She cannot be grappled.
Okay, so just slashes through, cannot be grappled. And then a 16 to hit. She takes 15 points of bludgeoning damage, reduced to 7.
Hold on, what was the first one, Nathan?
Oh yeah, sorry. First one was 12, reduced to 6. So 6 points.
Okay.
Next one is 7 points. So I'll just have it for you, and I'll just give you the number. Okay, the other one goes for Cherry. Another 16 to hit, so 6 points of bludgeoning. And a 10, so that will miss.
19 plus 4, she is down 23 hit points.
Okay, so carving into Cherry. The other one goes for Rin. Disadvantage, Glum?
Yeah, for the first one.
Okay. Okay, so a 21 to hit Rin.
Yeah,
definitely.
7 points of bludgeoning to Rin as it grabs you and pulls you back down into the water deeper. And then the tentacles wrap around you. Make a con save for me.
All right.
You 19. Resist the poison as you start to feel your limbs locking up, and then the other pincer comes in for a 20 to hit, and you will take 13 points of bludgeoning from that.
I just got those hit points.
All right, that was all of the crustacean creature's turns. It is now Glum.
All right. So this is the one that has Rin? Right here?
Sorry. Yes, that one has Rin. Yes. Yes.
Okay. Has been hurt yet?
No, it hasn't. It is fully up.
In that case, let me check the Thorn Whip spell real quick. Here. Okay. Is this creature large?
It is large. Yes.
It's large. Okay, cool. All right, so... So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have Scott move here and then swim me over to here. Is that 20 feet?
Yeah, totally. You can do that. You will provoke one attack of opportunity from the one creature next to you. So, I mean, if you want to go on the other side of that creature, you're going to get an attack of opportunity.
I do, and yes, go ahead.
Okay. So 20 to hit?
Yes, that's out. Exactly.
Okay, unfortunately you stop moving because it grabs onto you. You are grappled and you get stuck right where you are.
So, the important element to this?
Yeah.
Is there a floor, is there a sea underneath it?
Is there a what underneath it?
Is there water underneath it? Is it standing on the ground?
It's on the ground.
Oh, it's standing.
Yeah. So you take...
Oh, so... Mm-hmm. No, my question is there ground underneath it or is it swimming?
It's standing on the ground. So
okay. So I have an ability here, which I've been waiting to use forever. It is a shield that I got, which is called a shield of repelling, and it does this.
Oh, cool! Oh, I think I know what this is. Yeah.
Yeah, repelling shield. I'm trying to scroll all my stuff. I'm sorry, guys that are watching. Archangel. No. Hold on. Doing. Shot. Genius. Jesus. I know I have it. It's one of my things. It's right here. I just got to try
is
to.
Is it an artificer infusion or whatever?
Yes, it is.
It's like a repelling shield or something?
Exactly what it is, yeah. Repulsion shield. Okay, so. Here, I'll put in chat this. So once he hits me, I can expend one of the uses as a reaction, mm-hmm. and I can knock it back 15 feet away. And so that's going to automatically break the grapple because any movement against the creature will break a grapple.
Cool. Add me a hit, spend one of the shield's charges, and push the attacker up 15 feet away. Okay, cool. You will still take the 8 points of bludgeoning, but yeah, you blast it away.
That means it's also then because it's forced movement, it's also going to lose Rin.
Oh, it doesn't.
Any forced movement. If you
cool,
we can talk about after. After.
Yeah, I believe you. So that was not the one that was grabbing Rin, but yeah, but that the one that. Tried to, yeah. So it gets blasted away. Cool. So now you are on the other side of that creature.
Great, and I actually need to keep moving back this far.
Cool, okay.
Because I need to pull this thing to me in a second and not be there. So that one's also, did you already get my attack of opportunity on me or no?
They have a 10-foot range, so you're still within its...
Oh, okay, perfect. Okay, so now we use Thorn Whip.
Okay.
Just to try and pull this thing off of Rin.
Okay, so I think Thorn Whip is an attack roll?
Yep, sure is. Here it goes.
Oh.
Oh, horrible miss. Okay, that is it. And then as a bonus action, I'm going to... I guess he can't really do anything. He doesn't have any movement left. Scott's out of movement, right?
Scott is out of movement because he's underwater and you were here.
Okay.
And yep. He swam 20 feet, and he has 40-foot move
speed.
That
is my turn. Mm-hmm. My 5-minute turn is over.
Okay, so that one creature is blasted against the wall, and you swim over and try to Thorn Whip, but unfortunately miss, taking us to Aize.
All right, Chiri. Time to go to work, sweetie. Let's begin with... Oh, Aspen, you're up here. Okay. Have Archive go lower so I can get a better look. Or wherever Archive is. I'll just link through Archive mm-hmm. and identify which one of the big lobster monsters is the most wounded.
This one.
Okay, and the least wounded.
This one looks to be untouched.
That's the one that's harassing Rin?
That is, currently clutching Rin.
All right. Can I... Cheer it, beat the snot out of the one that's grabbing the little elf lady.
Okay.
And don't forget to protect yourself, dear.
All right, go ahead and make those two attacks.
I'm gonna try no matter hard as I can. If it gets loose,
that hits.
Hit, 15 points.
Nice.
And that's 11 to hit.
That will miss.
Okay, so she'll slam him, and I'm gonna drop the fireball here.
Got it.
This guy. Can I see the shark?
Nope. Archive doesn't see the shark.
All right. Then I'm only concerned about catching this guy and this guy.
Okay.
Fireball effect.
And yeah, to that point, all of you just saw Aspen disappear, but you don't. You just see the crustacean creatures. You don't see a shark. I mean, you don't know why she fled, but.
I kind of thought. Oh, and I make sure that I can see Glum.
Yeah, you can see Glum.
All
right. Right, yeah. Okay, so you catch those two. They make dex saves.
DC 17 dex saves using force.
They both fail.
Good. Use some good luck. Oh, shoot. No, right. Well. 30. Ooh, nice one. 35 points.
Five, nice. You're using force damage?
Yep.
So big flash of light and bubbles go spraying everywhere as this depth charge goes off. I would say just those of you in the water, so just Rin and Glum, you hear that shriek again in your mind. Ayize, that was anything else for your turn?
No, I'll save my reaction and bonus action.
Okay, excellent. All right. Swim, you fools. This is so weird. Okay. It is now. I think it's time to reveal Skothka. As Skothka comes swimming out from the darkness and comes swimming just to about here, just a little ways up. Ayize, you cannot see any of this. Only through Archive you were able to see this. That shape suddenly comes out of the tunnel, and you can see what looks to be an aboleth, but There are too many tentacles coming off of this one than the others. There appear to be extra appendages coming off the side of this, and they are slick and dark in coloration and kind of thick veins running through them that seem to sort of be pulsating as it comes. And those of you underwater see it looking up towards the hole.
Oh, so it's close enough to eat those two fireballs, I take it.
Oh, yep. And Skothka looks up at you, Ayize. You can't see them, but they are under the water. And first is going to use...
No, I was looking through Archive's
You eyes. Were. But this creature seems to know your tricks. And looks up, and first, Ayize, make a wisdom saving throw for me. Ten. Okay. So, Ayize, you hear the voice. You were muted if you're trying to...
I still have luck points.
Okay.
May I burn one?
Yes, you may.
Okay. Here we go again. 20?
You resist as you hear the voice come into your mind. No. No, I just... fine. And Skolthka is going to use their bonus action to cast Spiritual Weapon as a spectral tendril of writhing tentacles just appears before you. I use a...
And can I kind of spell that?
Yeah, you're within 60 feet.
I'm use a counter spell in my Ring of Spellstorm.
Okay, so it is fizzled out. Alright. And Skolthka is going to only move 10 feet, is going to swim away. And essentially out of sight to all of you. Although, wait, hold on, let me check something before I do that. Actually, hold on. No, it will, Skolthka will stay there. So that was Skolthka's action and bonus. Great, that takes us to Rin, you are up.
Yay, okay.
Remember, by the way, you could use your short sword if you wanted to.
Yeah. I normally would want to stay and fight, but I think I need to get out of that clutches as soon as I can. Yeah, I'm just going to use the action again and hope I have the same luck last time on getting out. So.
Marika, real quick check, do you have athletics? Because you might want to roll athletics instead.
I only have acrobatics. My acrobatics is where I have advantage.
You can roll acrobatics to break free of a grapple.
No, I was just saying if you have the athletics proficiency, because I noticed her roll is pretty low. That's fine. No, go for it. I almost slowed down the stream. Sorry.
Okay.
You're going to try to break free. Okay.
Yes, breaking free.
Right. Its claw clutches tightly around you. You get a 14. And I got a 9, so you break free. Where are you going, Rin?
Up.
Okay, so you swim up just to the surface. Are you gonna pop above to get to be above the water, or still stay underwater?
I as far as I understood, that there was a 5-ish foot gap from the water to the ledge. So I don't, if I could get up, but I don't think I could.
Sure, you could try to climb up. It will. So two things to note: it'll provoke an attack of opportunity.
Yeah.
And you won't be able to see the creatures under the water because it's murky. Like, Aspen was unable to see them once she got above the water.
Yeah.
You kind of have to be in the water to see them.
All I'm going to be able to do then is, if I can't just, so I'm not just bobbing in the water, just stick a hand out so at least those above can see where Rin is.
Okay, so.
But she'll stay underwater.
Okay.
And if I could also have Bert use this turn to swim up.
Swim up and out, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so pops up out above the water, kind of flicking off the water. Bert is just above the surface.
All right, I'll let those two watch him. I can't do anything after this, I believe, so.
Okay.
She's treading water.
Okay. At the end of your turn, Skolthka's going to use a legendary action to use Psychic Transference on Aize. So Aize, the voice pierces into your mind.
You're going to give me some of you, and you're going to drop that spell now.
Make a wisdom save for me. You fail and are going to take 10 points of psychic damage. And you hear Skolthka,
yes.
Make a concentration check for me, please. You are muted.
Sorry, I always worry about interrupting people, so I mute myself. Down to 24 points, just an FYI. Hey, Captain, we're both pretty beat up here. 1 and 2.
Yeah, I mean, with a 10, thankfully you have advantage. Yeah, 10, you just make it. You just hold on to Cherry. And Skulthka just kind of... all right, that was the end of Rin's turn. On initiative count 20, the lair action gets to go off again. Aspen, from out of the water, the shark bursts forth and wriggles what? Up. Aize, you don't see anything. You just suddenly see Aspen go, and it wriggles up and snaps, just barely grazing your foot, and you take... You only take 5 points of psychic damage. And Aize, you're just seeing Aspen react to something that is not there. Okay. Aspen, it is your turn.
Well, okay. So, for my bonus action, I really want to help with things down below, but I cannot. I can't right now. So, for my bonus action, I'm going to use my sorcery points, my 5 sorcery points, to get back a third level spell slot.
Okay.
But I'm going to use that spell slot. Can I see Rin?
You can just see Rin's hand up out of the water.
Okay, I'm going to do a mask healing word.
Okay.
And that's going to be for, I can't see Glum. So, sorry, Glum.
I'm only down 5, it's okay. 3, actually.
So that's 9 points of healing. Oh, that's max. That's not going to help me.
Thank you.
But, yeah. You're welcome. And I think I try to scoop back away from the hole. Is this shark like? Can I tell if the shark is gonna follow me?
What do you do?
Yeah, I just move away as far as possible from
okay.
the hole.
Okay, go ahead and make your movement. As you move away from the hole, you just see it's there, like trying to squeeze out of the hole. Trying to get at you. Aize seems like he's kind of I'm trying to think of how this. You just see Aize's focusing down at the water, and then I don't know, Aize, what do you do as Aspen like scurries away from the hole?
Are you alright, Aspen?
You don't see the giant shark? It's trying to.
There is no giant shark there.
Is a giant shark, it's right in front of you, Aize.
Ignore the giant shark. It's not there.
What do you mean ignore it? It's biting me.
Aspen, you see, as Aize is talking to you, you see that there's something wrong with his eyes. His eyes seem to be clouded over like he's been blinded.
It's that infernal Aboleth. He's in your head.
Oh, I need him to be out of my head.
Call upon your daddy or your mommy to help you.
Somebody help.
All right.
That is all I can do.
That is all you can do. Okay. All right. The big crustacean monsters again. The two of them are looking real hurt. They got hit by those fireballs, and they are going to swim over to Cherry and start going after Cherry. Or rather crawl over to Cherry. So here we go, 4 attacks on Cherry. 25 to hit. That'll be 6 points of bludgeoning to Cherry. A 24 to hit.
That's 3?
No, sorry, I'm gonna have it for you, so 6.
Okay.
24 to hit, so that is 7 points of bludgeoning. And a 23 to hit for 5 points of bludgeoning. And a 19 to hit. For 6 points of bludgeoning.
All right, Cherry's down, 47.
Okay. Carving into Cherry, trying to tear her apart, and then the other one looks up at the tasty little legs of Rin just floating above it as it lunges up and tries to grab onto Rin again. Oh, natural one, it misses. Next pincer comes up though and hits for a 23, and you are grappled once more, and you take 9 points of bludgeoning damage as it clutches onto you, and unfortunately, Rin, you are pulled back down into the depths.
So you just see Rin's hand, and it's suddenly pulled straight down into the water again.
Okay. That was their turn. Oh, and you are grappled, so the tentacles once more wrap around you, Rin. Go ahead and make a con save for me.
I almost rolled with the first con. Okay. Okay.
There you go.
At least I've been
you resist. You feel your muscles starting to tense up again, and you're having flashes of Aerolith there, frozen, unable to move, and just being torn to pieces. But you resist. Glum, you are up.
All right, it's time for me to do something fancy.
Do it.
Okay, so with Scott, we're going to move to there. It may be a different space based on what you tell me in a second, but I'm going to move here, and I have an attack that is a 60-foot cone.
Okay.
And I basically want to hit everybody in front of me except for Rin. Ideally, I would not hit Cherry, but I think she's so huge I can't avoid it. But I want to make sure I can get Skothka as well, which I'm pretty sure is within 60.
60-foot, yeah. You can get, I would say yes, you could get... Ooh. Avoiding Rin is going to be real tough.
Well, all I would do is angle down a little bit, right? Because it's 60 is the cone.
I see what you're saying. Okay, yeah, you'd be down at the bottom, and it would graze the one that's grabbing Rin. Yeah, sure. Yeah, that makes sense in my mind. Okay, what happens?
Oh, okay, so he's going to pull
out...
It will
hit Cherry, so Cherry will have to make this.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. But I think... I think it's force damage, so should be half damage, I don't know. So I take out one of my little crossbow bolts, and I go, and I throw it, and just kind of like weakly kind of floats forward, and then a barrage of them, like 100, appear and kind of float, and they all fire forward. So everyone has to make a, I believe it's a dex saving throw, DC 15.
Okay.
Let me confirm its dex real quick. It is... A dex. So dex 15.
Okay.
What's the damage type?
It is. I was just about to look at that. It is. It'll be piercing, so take half.
Cool.
Yeah.
But she. So Cherry has to make a dex save?
Yes.
Okay, and it's piercing, so the damage is half anyway. Okay.
Yeah.
So it could be quartered if she succeeds.
17
does.
On the deck save?
Yeah, you made it.
Okay, what's the damage?
Double perfect. Is. Okay. Ooh, 17 points.
Nice.
So it'll be 8 for you.
Well, it'll be 4 points to Cherry.
Okay, yeah. There you go. 4. So 17 if they don't make it, half of that if they do make it.
Nice. One of the, I'll just say their name now. One of the Tuul, which are these crustacean creatures, drops dead as bolts just rip into shreds. The other ones are still standing. One of them's looking really hurt. Skothka sort of rears to the side and takes the brunt of it on the side and doesn't seem to hurt him that bad.
Okay, so lastly, how much movement does Scott have?
Well, you basically swam back to where you were, so that was about 40 feet-ish. Sorry, it was about 20 feet-ish, because you were, like, here, I think?
Okay, so that's...
Yeah.
So he's got no more movement left.
Yeah.
Okay, then that's it.
Okay, so... and one of them just... is destroyed. Nice, very good, very awesome move there, Glum. Taking us to Aiese.
Okay, let's... Oh, this... Alright, I'm gonna catch Skothka and this turd here, and then Ice Storm.
Ice Storm, okay. That was the one you cast earlier, correct?
Yep.
Okay, so under the water, suddenly things of hail and light come shooting through. They all make dex saves?
Here, hang on. I will display in BTT. There you go.
Yep, dex saves. Okay. Okay.
There's the damage.
19 damage. And your spell save DC is?
17.
17, okay. All right, so the one Chul is eviscerated, torn to pieces, and is destroyed, leaving only one left. And Skolka, did Skolka roll? Skolka did not roll. Here we go, dex save. Got a 4. Yeah, Skolka will take that damage. Okay, 17 points of damage.
How does Rin look? Is she in really bad shape?
I don't know, Rin.
Let me not tell you what literally it looks like. So, she's looking pretty hurt, but she's like still has a lot of stamina to keep fighting, if that gives you. So she's very hurt.
Jerry, kill the aboleth.
Okay, so she's gonna swim over to the aboleth, provoking an attack of opportunity. Here we go. And misses with a 9. Go ahead and roll attacks.
The aboleth is large, I take it?
Correct.
Alright, so she can't engulf them.
Right.
This would be really fun. Well, actually, let me see here. Can she? Go. Wow. It can work against a large opponent. I'm looking at Whelm, Nathan.
Okay. Yeah, if it says it
can work. Small, it also grappled.
They become grappled if they fail?
Yeah, DC 14.
Okay. So Cherry has to occupy the same space.
Yep.
And creates a whirlpool, essentially. And what kind of saving throw?
Yeah, she can grapple up to one large creature or two medium.
Okay.
DC 15 strength saving throw, but she has to hit first.
Got it. Okay, go ahead and roll to hit.
Oh, that was damage. Oh, damn it. Sorry, my mistake.
That's okay. Well, I thought they just make a save. Yeah. So.
Yeah, they just make a save. That's it.
Okay, so he rolled a 20 on his save, so he succeeds. So he is not grappled, and he will take half damage.
He takes half damage.
Yeah, so is that's 33 total, so 16?
16 points.
Okay. Okay. There's just a cloud of bubbles and silt over where Skolka is. Anything else for you, Aize?
I just yelled, stay on him!
All right. That is going to take us to... actually at the end of your turn, before it goes to his turn, he's going to use a legendary action, he had one left, to tail swipe to tail swipe Cherry. So a big wad of tentacles comes slamming into Cherry. Oh, only a 19 to hit. So misses, I think. Yeah?
What?
A 13 to hit. So 13 to hit.
That
so
just misses.
Just misses Cherry. Okay, then it takes us to Skolka's turn. Skolka is going to... Let me see here. Yeah, Skolka's going to first use another second level spell to cast Spiritual Weapon up at you, Aize. Unless you counter it.
All out of counters.
Okay, so it appears next to you, this writhing mass of tentacles. And it's going to try to slam into you. Let me see. Here we go. A 15 to hit. Misses? Okay, so misses. And then...
My armor class is 16.
Okay. And then he's going to... Cherry's looking pretty hurt, yes? Although I guess an elemental... Yeah.
Not really. She is 51 out of a She's down 51 out of 114 hit points.
Okay.
I mean, she's halfway.
Yeah.
Actually, better than halfway. Five.
Okay. Sorry, I'm trying to be decisive here. I know that
we're... Just 63 hit points left.
I know that we're getting low on time. And here we go. Oh, wait. Ha! Oh, I need to look something up. Sorry, guys, this is crucial. I need to look up how this works. Okay. Ooh. What level spell is Cherry?
Fifth. I mean, Conjure Elemental is fifth level.
Hold on, that spiritual weapon attack on you should have been, what did I say, 15?
Yeah.
That actually should have been, sorry, the stat block is, so by the way, this is the stat block that Claire helped me with. It's a custom one. That actually should have been a 19 to hit.
I will use a shield spell with that.
Okay, so it is blocked. And yeah, I think... yeah.
Are you thinking of Dispel Magic?
I was, yes. I would just have to make an ability check, I believe.
I'm not sure how that works.
It says you can target a creature, so it could work on Cherry, but I would have to make an ability check to...
Okay.
Yeah.
Because it's not a third level spell, right? Oh, actually, well, let me look up this spell.
You said you said the elemental spell was a fifth level spell, right?
Yep.
Yeah, so yeah. Yeah. Okay, yeah. I think that he will... I think he's just going to cast Spirit Guardians. That's what he's going to do. So, you watch as these spectral tendrils and tentacles come writhing out from Skolfka in a 15-foot aura... And anything within it is going to be not having a great time. And then Skolfka is going to move right there.
That gets an opportunity attack from Cherry then.
Because Cherry has a 10-foot range or a 5-foot range?
She has a 10-foot reach.
10-foot reach. Yeah, he'll take it. Okay, go ahead, make the opportunity attack.
Actually, let me check that, the reach thing.
As these tendrils come flying out to you all.
What's that saving throw?
It does not affect you yet. It affects you at the start of your turn.
Gotcha. What if I don't start my turn?
Well, then, you know, we'll just be here forever.
The stream that never ends.
Yeah.
Actually, no, the slime is only 5-foot reach.
5-foot reach. Okay. So go for it. Make an attack of opportunity. Spirit Guardian says when the creature enters the area for the first time on a turn or starts its turn there, it must make a wisdom saving throw. So I guess, did you enter? I don't think you enter. You didn't enter it. This is because this is 4. So yeah, it'll just be at the start of your turn. Okay, 21. That hits 15 damage. That is a solid hit. that was Skolfka's turn. At the start of your turn, Rin, I need you to make a wisdom saving throw for me.
All right. Oh.
You can have a +3. Rin!
+3, that'll bring it to a 16.
Rin, resist it. Yeah.
Resistant.
Okay. You manage to resist, but you will still take half of this damage. So you take 8 points of necrotic damage as the tendrils start lacerating you and wrapping around your arms, taking us... Rin, what would you like to do with your turn, Rin?
Seeing as she got pulled down twice,
yes,
she's going to pull out her short sword, which literally no one has ever seen her pull this out.
Yeah.
That's how bad it has gotten.
And they're like, she's got a sword?
For all the time you've worked with her, no one has seen her short sword. So much so that I don't even have it written down, so I'm just going to just roll with a
D20. It'll be a BD at 20 plus 7, because your dex is 16.
All right. So...
Hey, there you go.
All right. That hits.
All right. So,
wait, what are you... Who are you attacking?
It's just the one that's still grappling.
Okay, yeah, go for it.
Only one, right? So yeah. She just pulls it out and just got...
You took plus 3. Yeah, awesome. You
roll damage. Plus 3,
Erica.
Plus 3.
So that's 5.
You get two attacks.
5 points of damage, okay.
Oh, even on the short sword, that's great.
Yeah.
Go for it.
Plus 17.
17, that hits. Yeah, that hits.
Six.
Right.
So what?
9 points.
So 9 points, okay. Nice, those two strikes. It's looking hurt. Anything else for you, Rin?
Well, just since we're right at the end of the game, we're going to send Bert down right again.
Yeah, okay. Go Bert.
Bert's going to go for the one that's grappling you?
Yes.
Okay, go for it.
Now, can't Bert get on the other side of it and get advantage?
Yeah, sure. Definitely, yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Go for it. Roll with advantage.
You just hear ka and then just dot. Roll.
Come on, Bert.
Great. I don't think...
23,
that hits. How much damage?
Please!
9 points of damage. Okay, also, Bert slamming into the water enters the spell, the Spirit Guardians. I need Bert to make a wisdom saving throw.
Come on, Bert Brain! Be strong!
Come on, Bert!
13. Oh, no. Bert suffers 15 points of necrotic damage.
Luckily, Bert's got a 9th level Beastmaster, so. He's got 50, right?
40. But yes. He's not. It's the first time he's been hit in a while.
Okay. That takes us to. Anything else for you, Rin?
That is everything.
Okay. That takes us to initiative count 20 for the lair actions.
You didn't skip my turn, right?
Did I?
I had a 23 for my initiative.
No, yeah. It took so long for me to get through Skulfka's turn because I was figuring out the spells. Sorry. Yeah. No, we did not. You did the cone. Okay, on initiative count 20, how many people are in the water? The shark disappears for you, Aspen.
Yay!
As it goes away. And you see that Aize's eyes seem to be fine. They kind of clear over. But then... Yeah. Okay, yeah, a couple things. So, all of you in the water, so Rin and Glum, I need you to make wisdom saves for me as the cackle spills into your mind. The cackle of Skulfka.
Cackle of me.
Almost rolled Bert's, which is
and Bert, no. Yes, and Bert. So all of the creatures in the water. I guess Cherry as well. Cherry, unless Cherry is immune to psychic damage, but Cherry needs to make this save as well. So, Rin, you succeed with a 19.
Oh, sorry. That's Bert and then...
Oh, Bert got a 19? Okay, so Bert succeeds. Rin, you succeed with a 20. Cherry fails with a 5. You fail with a 14, Glum. And Glum and Cherry are both going to take 5 points of psychic damage as you hear the cackle in your mind. And Skolka's going to use...
Thanks to Intellect Fortress, I take 2 points of damage. I'm resistant to psychic. I describe that as putting two earplugs in, so I hear that.
Nice. Skolka's going to use another legendary action to do psychic transference again on Aize.
I will make you drop that spell. I will!
Make another wisdom save for me.
Wisdom save?
Yes.
How is he seeing me? Like, he sees me, is he... okay, I'll take care of this line of sight nonsense next round. He might survive this.
Yeah, because he's below you and you're still standing at the lip of the hole.
24.
24, you succeed, you'll take half this damage. So you take 5 points of psychic damage to make another concentration check for me. And Rin and Glum, you can see that some of the wounds on Skolka start to kind of seal shut, and you hear Skolka. Oh, wow, you just held concentration. Oh my goodness. Okay, that was legendary action and lair action. Taking us to Aspen, it is your turn.
Oh man, yeah, he's gone. I just walk back over to the hole.
Yeah, he's trying to kill me.
I slice my hand and I let the blood like coagulate in the water.
Okay.
And I don't need to see.
Oh, Aspen, I can get up. I need you to make a wisdom saving throw for me as you walk into the tendrils that are lashing out, because the Spirit Guardians is a 15 foot around the creature and it is reaching up through that hole.
18.
Okay, so you'll take half this damage.
I am also resistant to necrotic damage.
Okay, so you take 8 points of necrotic, reduced again to 4. So 4 points of necrotic damage. Sorry to interrupt. Go ahead. Drop the blood in the water.
Yeah, I looked this up. I will post it again. I will post it again so you can read it.
Okay.
So you can see it. I don't need to see, but I can. This is it has a range of 120 foot, so I will hit the bottom of the ground.
Cool.
And it is a 40 foot cube, so whoever I can get in that 40 foot cube has to make a DC wisdom.
Okay.
DC 17 wisdom save.
So the question is then, because that will hit your allies, can you.
It is, I can choose. The creatures of my choice.
Okay, perfect. Then yeah, they will. The two creatures down there will make. What was the save?
DC 17.
DC 17 wisdom?
Yes.
Okay, let's start with the Chul. Wisdom 15, so fails. The Chul is slowed. And the and Skolka makes a wisdom save. Gets a 12. Skolka is going to burn a legendary resistance and automatically succeed. As the spell tries to take hold. Okay.
And for my bonus action, I'm gonna get back some sort of 3 points with the second level spell.
Cool.
Yeah, and that is, I think that was only like 15 movement from here to here, 20?
Yeah.
So I still have 10.
Yeah, so this is-
I'm gonna just back up.
So hold up, because this is real tricky. With Spirit Guardians, it's difficult terrain.
Okay.
Spirit Guardians, speed is halved. So I'd say you could just get to the edge there to do all that. So.
Okay. Well, then I can't move. All right.
Okay.
Yeah, I guess I stay there.
Okay, at the end of your turn, Skolka is going to use another legendary action and do a tail swipe. And swing it right at 10 foot reach. I think we'll go for just out of range. I guess just Rin. That's all Skolka can go for. So tail swipe right at Rin. Sorry, Rin. Wow, roll the natural one. You are super lucky. the slowed Chul in that moment, just as the spell was taking effect, kind of slumped over, and the tail went right over your head. Okay, that is, it's now the Chul's turn, so all it can do is an action. And if it has
multiple attacks, it just does one.
All right. So a 17 to hit Rin. I don't think that hits. And that's all it can do, and then it takes, then it gets to make a save, right?
Yes.
Okay. It got a 2, so it is still stuck trying to grab Rin. Glum, you are up. At the start of your turn, Glum, make a wisdom saving throw for me.
So, that Intellect Fortress is great. It's basically all saving throws are advantage.
Nice.
You go, oh, except for when you roll 11.
So you take 12 points of necrotic.
Okay.
And I need you to make a concentration check for Intellect Fortress.
Okay. And then what are we doing? Oh, concentration. Yes,
yeah,
of course.
Concentration.
So I took 12. So what's the, how does that work?
You just need to get, you make a concentration saving throw and you need to get a 10 or higher.
Easy peasy. There you go.
Okay, you still got it up. What would you like to do with your turn?
Okay. Let's see.
And I know we're at time, so we'll go to Rin's turn and then we'll call it there.
Okay, cool. I think so this is the one that has Rin still, right?
Yes.
I think I'm just gonna unload on that guy.
Go for it.
I look at Scott's guy and say, you annoy me.
You're unloading on Skolka or on the Chul, the crab monster?
No, I say, you annoy me, but then I turn to the Chul and I say, but you have my friend.
Go for it.
Go. Okay, so one. What do I got there?
Yeah, 20, that hits.
Okay, cool, damage is...
Is it 8 points or 18?
18. No, 18. This is with my sharpshooter.
It is with sharpshooter. Okay, so it's still up.
Okay, and again. What do I got there?
13, that misses, even with the minus 2 to AC.
All right. 17.
17, that hits.
15 more.
15 more. It's barely hanging on to life. All right. Anything else for you, Glum?
Yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and we're both gonna move. We're here, so.
Cool.
If my buddy needs a AC bonus, we can help some disadvantage. That's it.
Perfect. Ayize, it is your turn. At the start of your turn, please make a wisdom saving throw for me.
Six.
Six, sorry. Six will be a failure. You are going to take 16 points of necrotic damage, and I need you to make a wisdom saving throw.
Why am I taking damage? Just curious.
So the spiritual guardians, it's a 15-foot aura around the aboleth, and the aboleth is swimming kind of at the midpoint of the grotto, so it's spilling up through the hole in the ground up to you.
Okay. 16 points of damage, and I need to make a con saving throw for this, right?
Yes.
Just to maintain my spell? 16?
Yes, you maintain it. Alright.
Okay. Chiri, get on him.
She swims over.
And she will go for an engulf again.
Okay, so another strength saving throw.
He needs a DC 15.
That is a natural one. He's gonna burn another legendary resistance to automatically succeed.
Okay, well, here's the wound damage.
Okay. It's supposed to be half damage.
13 points.
13 points, okay. he is getting battered.
Am I familiar with this particular spell effect that he's using?
It looks to be a spiritual guardian spell, which is a cleric spell, which is odd.
I just want to know, if I move, am I going to take damage?
Oh, no, but you are at half movement, so you can only move about 15 feet.
All right, I'm going to move away. Well, no. First, I'm going to throw a level 2 magic missile at him.
Okay. Go ahead and roll the damage.
I'll do it. I haven't used this yet. I'll do it through Archive.
You do it through Archive, okay.
I'll fire them through Archive, level 2. Magic missile, 1, 2, 3, 4.
How much damage total?
6 and 4, 10 and 4 is 4, 4, 3, 3. That's 14 and 4 is 18 points of damage.
18 points of damage, okay. Okay, and then Skulfgod needs to make 2 concentration checks, and succeeds on both, maintaining the spell. And then you back away, okay?
Yep.
Alrighty.
How do I minimize the zoom? Actually, never mind. Go ahead.
Okay.
I accidentally expanded my zoom screen and it's taking up my whole screen.
Oh, no! Okay. Skulfgod is... It is now Skulfka's turn. Skulfka is going to...
Can I say something?
Yeah.
Hey, Skulfka, you want a piece of me? That's it.
Sorry. No, this creature is very intelligent. It is going to just swim up. It will go... Let's see. Is that the midpoint? Swim 10 feet up. I guess it will provoke an attack of opportunity from Cherry and Rin. So both of you can make attacks of opportunity. But it is going to essentially swim up to the hole and sort of pull itself up through the hole right to where you are, Aspen. And it's just going to unleash tentacle attacks. It has a 10-foot range, so it's going to go straight for Aize.
Just have Rin and Cherry attack first?
Yeah. Go ahead and make your attacks.
This is going to be no sharpshooter business with this one.
I did move 15 feet back. Yeah.
You moved 15 feet back? Okay, so it has 55 feet of movement for swim, so it can get to the top easy enough. And then it has 20-foot movement speed, so it's able to pull itself up out of the hole and get that extra 5 feet for the 10-foot range to slam it.
Oh my god!
So it is fully like pulling out through the wood, pushing past you, Aspen, just getting slammed into the wall, feeling the slime and the slick moving past you as it's just going for Aize. And Aize, you hear in your head, "You have been the bane of everything! You will die!" And it's just crawling at you.
I'm very sorry, I hurt your feelings.
Okay,
so that's for since I had the short sword out.
That
so.
Hits. Go ahead and roll the damage.
6 plus 3. Yes, 7 more.
7 more points of damage. Okay.
That's
16 points of slam damage from Cherry.
And 16. Okay, so I'm gonna make another 2 concentration checks. Boom, boom. Succeeds on both. And then just goes all 3 tentacle attacks straight at Aize. So an 11 misses, a 20 will hit.
Shield spell.
Okay. But a 24 will hit. Slamming into you. You take 16 points of bludgeoning damage, and I need you to make a constitution saving throw.
Sorry, hold on. My character's just crashed.
No!
The site can't be reached. What the hell?
No! We were almost there.
No, I think you took Aize out.
What was Aize's hit points at?
After all that crap, what do you think?
I don't know. What was Aize's hit points
at? I'll see you in the turn order, so I don't
know if it's
just you. I have
12 hit points left. I'm at minus 4.
Oh, wow. Okay, so Aize goes unconscious onto the ground. And
it climbed up out of the water to kill me.
and Cherry, the elemental in the water with the nice blue eyes kind of flickering of light, suddenly the eyes sort of flash a silver and it looks around with a sudden self-awareness. I think we should probably end there. That seems like a really good spot to end.
And real quick,
we love to see it. That was awesome.
But real quick, actually, because I'm going to forget otherwise, Aspen, it does do a spiritual weapon attack on you. Sorry, because it still has that spell.
It is.
But it misses with a, it misses with a 13. So. But anyways, yeah, we're going to end there.
So real quick. First, Scottish Jeff, good to see you again. It's been a long time. I think Humming Bell also was here a long time ago as well. So welcome to both of you. But lastly, Tiny14, who's, I don't know if I figure her own name yet. She will be joining us for the last leg of this campaign with her character cosplay. She's a TikToker and a Twitch streamer. So just wanted to welcome her to watching her first show with us.
Amazing. Yeah, thank you so much, Tiny14, for jumping in, and we look forward to having you as a guest later.
Is she coming next Monday?
No, I'm sorry, but no. you guys got to figure this out. But this is very exciting. I'm really interested to see what happens. Skullska, by the way, is looking hurt, but is murderous Avalon going for the kill. All right, we will see you all next week and see what happens, and I hope Chris still likes me as a friend after all this. We'll see you.
Everything after me, like.
All right, everyone have a lovely evening. We will see you next time. Good night.